forward at the great race.
Michelle Helix corner. Michelle and goes.
The first three races were held at Phillip Island, Victoria. They were purely class affairs, and the classes based on price. There was no award for first across the line, and the cars were started in groups, the big cars first. Here's the 1960 start. First across the line in that first race was Frank Code with co-driver John Roxburgh.
I remember we had a good car and I had a good co-driver. We were very lucky, and I think that anyone that wins a 500 has to be lucky. The opposition all fell over and we were quicker. I think it was a good track, a good day. The only thing that happened, we hit a seagull, I think. We ran out of brakes. And it seems a long time ago. It's probably the last amateur 500, I suppose. It's the way I look back on it now. I've been in most of them since, and I think it's the last amateur one we're ever in. And we're probably the first people to have a professional pit crew, I suppose. It's probably what set the race going from where it is to where it is now, is that it had a fair impact on sales in our particular case. We were driving a Vauxhall Cresta, and they didn't have many Vauxhall Crestas to sell, I since discovered, and they ran out of them very quickly, and they were very happy, so I suppose they were the first happy sponsor. Has to be a first crew one. Been an awful lot of unhappy ones since, but the next 2 years, of course, things got more tough, and we drove Vauxhalls both times, Frank Code and I, and the second year, I think it'll be 61, I crashed the damn thing, and it took about 11 and 12 minutes to get it going again, and we lost the race by about 3/4 of a minute, I think. And the following year, Cody crashed it, so we ended up all pretty even on that score. And we were driving a better car in some ways, but we had some front end problems. Of course, over those last 2 years, the track got terribly rough, and it was like the Red X trial, and what happened was that people began to have troubles which you don't normally have motor racing. It was more like motor trialing. Holes this deep came in the track, and we were one of that fell by the wayside because of that. And basically that's what happened to the race, I suppose. That's why it came to Bathurst in the beginning. The track got cut up so badly in the last event at Phillip Island that the club couldn't repair it, and it actually put the track out of existence for, I suppose, about 5 or 6 years, and that's why it moved up to Bathurst.
1963, and the Bathurst circuit first closed for the 500. On the grid were 56 cars, 16 different makes, made or assembled in Australia.
There he is.
For the third time, Bob Jayne and Harry Firth were in the winning car, a Ford Cortina GT. '64, and Bob Jayne made it four in a row, driving this time with George Reynolds. His old partner Harry Firth was third. 1965, and if tyres hold out, the Cortina needs only to pit once to maintain Ford's front-running reputation. 17.5 gallons fed to two tanks from above the boot top, and oil-tight filler sealed up. Ford's strategy is again steered by their ace man Les Powell. Veterans Bill McLaughlin and Jellic Knight Jack Murray pilot one of the 500s, trying to give Ford line honours in 5 out of the 6 Armstrongs. Let's go with the original commentary to set the scene and the era.
A complete traffic jam surges forward in a haze of exhaust and tyre smoke. Next few minutes, bedlam as they sort themselves out. Watch them use the inside grass. This is a place where patience pays off. There's all day to go. Last through, Fiat 850, Heffernan at the wheel. Two still in front, 10 has overtaken Gagan. Then McPhee, Cortina 4, 80 yards ahead of the field. This breakaway was more or less as expected. The Studebakers, knowing they'd spend more time in the pits, trying to get well out in front. They thought those 17 and a half gallons would hold the Cortinas back. But despite 120 mile an hour down Conrad, they're right there, Gagan close. Jane, Gagan and Foley, then three more minutes with two white Cortinas, believing that the prize is not always to the quickest. Gagan and Foley have swapped positions, but Jane still makes the running. Suddenly, Jane was alone in front and going like a rocket. The road seemed open for Cortina's fourth and Jane's fifth laurel. There's proof that seat belts are lifesavers. Driver not hurt. It was caused by a busted wheel. And the passing cars don't seem to be going quite so fast. Never rains, but it pours. 3 minutes later and Jane is out, putting an end to any chance of his fifth Armstrong in a row. He was lapping just over 3:15. Average, just around 70 mile an hour. And now serious engine trouble. Here comes Seaton, first D-class and outright, still purring round in 3:17. But 3 and 4 is second, and ready to take the Ford baton if Seaton has trouble. Creditable third-class D, veterans McLaughlin and Murray, around 3:19, faster than several younger men in the same car. Age brings wisdom, but it doesn't destroy skill. That sounds glorious. Seaton's taking it easy. To ensure no accident, a lap ahead and the end near. Bart Moggridge waits for number 11. There he goes. That's the end, 4:16. 24 minutes faster than last year. 42 finished out of 53. Outright Seaton, McPhee, Foley. D-class, Cortina 1-2-3. Yes, the 1965 Armstrong was memorable. Most interesting so far. It takes 1,001 to stage it, to find one outright winner. As we go home with Barry and Midge, a thank you to them and to the other 999.
1966 and a new sponsor, and it looks like the three-year mortgage by Ford Cortina was about to finish. The X500 was no longer eligible. Triple winner Bob Jane was not driving. Reynolds driving a Bellette, Harry Firth and Barry Seaton and Mitch Bremsworth all driving Mini Cooper S's. 1967, the introduction of the Falcon.
56 feet, tread on the pedal, and some $100,000 surges forward in a blue haze of burnt rubber. Now for one of the worst moments of the whole day. Waiting your turn and keeping clear of the straining metal. Using your skull. Top of mountain straight, and Spencer Martin has joined Gagan and Gibson in the lead. The three alphas have dropped back, perhaps to play a waiting game. Two-thirds gone, Forest Elbow, and the three big Falcons, still Gagan, Gibson, Martin, open a sizable lead on the field. Then two more Falcons, a Studebaker, and the three Alphas. End of lap two, and Spencer Martin slides into second spot. Gibson content to fall back. Right behind him came Gibson, the orthodox way, to hand over to awaiting Harry Firth. Note the teamwork on the windscreen. Look at the brake pads, no change. She's surging a bit up the hill. Don't you turn that ignition on. Right, away you go, in the lead by 1 minute. Suddenly, Martin in real trouble. Turned out later that faulty fitting had broken the beads on all wheels, causing constant tire trouble. Four times winner Jane won't be making it five. Firth has just taken under 3 minutes to change both front brake pads. Unbelievable but true. New brake pads and only 2 minutes behind Gagan. Gibson back at the helm. Harry Firth knows that Gibson's now over a minute in front, but he has one more pit stop to go. Chivers in the same lap just in front of Gagan, and he has another stop to make. The Firth pit board tells Gibson he's 1 minute up on Gagan, but that pit stop's still to come. And here's that vital pit stop. Gagan about 56 seconds behind. Less than an hour to go. Firth in control. Do nothing. No time to change drivers. Get that petrol in. 5 gallons. Give Gibson a drink. And go. Actual stop, 25 seconds. Still in front, but not by much. Go out and join two other tense men. Not at these speeds. Here's the actual difference between Gibson and Gagan on the last lap. Gibson is the dark car up front. Hold it and you'll see Gagan in 53. There he goes, 11 seconds behind. Down at the tower, quiet consternation. Word is that Gagan's in front. Firth later said he was dumbfounded when he didn't get the flag. Well, there's a turn-up for the books. TV commentator speechless. Pit crew's not really surprised. It was always close. Gagan grinning. No changes in the other classes. Gibson on his way round for another lap, wondering whose mathematics are at fault.
When the dust settled and lap scorers were able to sort out the mess, it was the master Harry Firth who took the win, with new chum Fred Gibson. For him, the Gallagher 500 was a special event in that it signified his formal entry into the big time.
The whole year was my first year of driving for the Ford Motor Company, and I think I can just relate back for a few minutes to having met Harry Firth for the first time in the motel room on the Thursday night of practice, and this guy was sort of in charge of Ford Motor Company then, was this gruff old fellow, and I was the 20-something-year-old kid that's come along into the team. I was lucky to get the drive. I was recommended by Frank Manage actually for the drive, because Frank was going to drive with Harry. And I met Harry and he was sitting on the bed and I said, well, how are you going and how do you think we'll go? And he said, well, Fredo, he said, there's no substitute for cubic capacity. And he said, against an alpha, we'll fix them up sort of thing. So that was the first introduction to the weekend. We had a pretty good weekend and we thought we won the race, but it was a bit of a disappointment to sort of, at the finish of the race, the lap scorers had done it all wrong and they give it to Pete and Leo Gagan, which was a bit of a blow to the whole system, because here I was thinking I'd won Bathurst, my first attempt in a big car, and I didn't win Bathurst. So, you know, and Harry wasn't really impressed at all. But that was 67. It was a good race. I think I enjoyed driving for Ford Motor Company at the stage then, and with people like Pete and Leo Gagan.
What about the cars? I mean, they're so radically different to what we see today. We become so used to our Group A touring cars. They had bicycle tyres and they lurched and smoked.
Well, we run in Michelin, I think, X or something or other, where they were, some skinny little tyres. And that was also new to me because I was on driving race cars at this time then. So to hop into this thing, they slipped and slid all over the road. And, I couldn't believe how they used to lurch and lean. So, and then it had all this V8 grunts, so I used to light the tyres up pretty well. So it was a new experience, and to say, like, you think about the day and what's happened today in racing, and I can't really believe back to those old times now, really.
In the Ford camp, the Gagan brothers, Leo and Pete, sporting a new crash helmet, are confident of better luck than in past 500s. They were flagged in first last year, but lost on a recount of laps. Pole position on the grid following fastest practice times yesterday are the new Holden Monaros.
1968, and it's a new battle. The General attacks.
A good early position is vital, so they hurtle into Hell Corner, determined to make or take the early running. By the time they reach the S's, Des West's Holden Monaro, number 14, has hit the front, followed by the Holdens of Hawkins, Muir and Palmer, then the Falcons of Gagan and Gibson. After 1 hour, 15 minutes, Des West in the Monaro is still ahead, and Holdens dominate the leading positions. The first Falcon, number 9, is 23 seconds behind. Meanwhile, the front runners have reached the halfway mark, and following pit stops by all, there's been a change of leaders. Car 9, the Gibson Seaton Falcon, has hit the front, followed by Car 8, the Gagan Falcon. Leo's going to try and go the distance without a brake change, as he did last year when only narrowly beaten. By lap 90, the outright placings are Seaton, Gagan, then the Monaros of Des West, number 14, Bruce McPhee, 13, Jim Palmer, 24, Brian Muir, 25, and Paul Hawkins, 23. Car 9 is still ahead, but just when the Ford camp's becoming confident, real trouble strikes the Gagan machine. The Falcon's disc brakes burn out. Replacement takes 16 minutes. A quarter of an hour later, it's the leader, Barry Seaton, in with a suspected blown head gasket. Time is running out, and every second vital. A radiator refill, some rapid cooling, and the car is sent back onto the track. Then another blow, in more ways than one, and this time, Seaton is definitely out of the race. With the two Fords out, West Monaro takes the lead again, but he too has a pit stop to make, which must put McPhee in front with no more scheduled stops. Coming up to the checkered flag, McPhee has broken the race record set last year by the Falcons. His time, 6 hours, 44 minutes, 7.9 seconds, is 11 minutes better than the old record. The largest crowd in the history of the race has come to see what promises to be the most thrilling motor race of its kind ever staged, with main interest in the battle for line honours between the new and specially built Ford Falcon GTHOs and the car that won convincingly last year, the Holden Monaro GTS. Ford won in 67, so today's race is something of a decider. With fuel stops expected to play a big part in the final result, they save every ounce by pushing to the start. Ford Managing Director W.O. Burke talks with pre-race favourites Leo and Pete Gagan. Past winners Fred Gibson and Barry Seaton. Gibson in 1967, Seaton 2 years earlier. They'll be in a Falcon. Last year's victors Barry Mulholland and Bruce McPhee have this year switched to Ford, and McPhee will again drive all but one of the 130 laps. David Mackay is another Ford convert, while on the other hand, Harry Firth has switched to the Holden dealer's camp as team manager.
1969, of the 60 cars entered, 15 were the new Ford Falcon GTHO.
Don Smith's Datsun is first casualty as it brushes the fence opposite the pits, but considering the size of the field, it's an incident-free start. They swarm through Hardy Verodo Corner and up Mountain Straight. And that's just what happens as they race over the top of the mountain. One car rolls in front of the field, all but blocking the track. Others, unable to slow, cannon into each other. Four cars are write-offs and 15 others get a buffeting. Forrest Elbow and Pete Gagan has a 200-yard lead over the Falcons of David Mackay, Bruce McPhee and Fred Gibson. Then come the Holdens of Digby Cook, Colin Bond and Des West. Bill Brown's Falcon is one of the worst victims. Paul Mander's Mini will be off the track for some time. Alan Kant's Capri is another with low mileage, going cheap. This year, roll bars were permitted again, and there's little doubt they saved serious injury here. Gagan is clear leader after 20 miles, and with him now, David Mackay's GTHO. Then the GTSs of Cook and Bond, the McPhee Falcon, and the West Monaro. Out again after 4 minutes, but now Digby Cook is leader. Now the Bond Roberts Holden takes over, and though their lead is only a narrow one, it's considerably improved when Fred Gibson brings in his car, which is now second. This is the car Firth fears most. He won a 500 with Gibson as co-driver and makes no secret of his respect for Seaton's sedan steering. They fit two new tyres and take on 12 gallons of fuel.
You can never say you've won here until you have done the 130th lap. We are in front, not by that much actually, but we think that McPhee has to make another stop.
And sure enough, McPhee does pit. Only for 5 gallons, but enough to put him too far back to catch the Bond Holden as it heads for the checkered flag. 6 hours, 32 minutes, 25 seconds their time for the 500 miles, just over 12 minutes better than last year's Holden record for the race.
1970, the Ford team was masterminded by American Al Turner, and he hedged his bets by partnering Seaton and Gibson in one car, with Bruce McPhee and Alan Moffat as lone drivers in his two other cars. And the rest of the Falcons were mainly dealer entries. And the results? They speak for themselves.
Taking advantage of the pole position, Moffat leads up Mountain Straight, with Bond skillfully manoeuvring into second place ahead of Seaton and McPhee. Flashing down Conrad for the first time, Moffat is trailed by Seaton and Bond. In the braking area, Bond pulls out to easily gather in Moffat and Seaton and takes the lead as he negotiates the left-hander into pit straight. Sensing a battle in the David Goliath mold, the huge crowd acclaims Bond as he speeds past the pits, his XU1 going perfectly. But Moffat and Seaton use a little more thrust to keep him within reach as they again head up the mountain. After five laps, Moffat regains the overall lead. Resisting Bond's challenge to an early duel, Moffat instead concentrates on pre-race set speeds. Excitement surrounds Moffat's first scheduled pit stop after 45 laps. As new tyres are being fitted on the GTHO and fuel replenished by a well-drilled pit crew, Des West's four-barrel Pacer flashes past to take over the lead. But Alterna is unperturbed.
We've made our first stop and with Bruce McPhee, and it took 2 minutes and 9 seconds to change three tyres, and we put in 25 gallons of fuel. We've got Moffat fueled up again with four tyres and 25 gallons, and they're both out now. And we'll just have to see how it goes.
Firmly entrenched as leader, Moffat is well in command, while McPhee holds a backup position in second place. Bond's Holden is going well again, but he's many laps behind. There's an atmosphere of calm confidence in the Ford camp. Their pit crew has been by far the fastest during stops, and Moffat is capitalizing on time saved. Moffat has more than a lap advantage over Holland, so the XU1 faces an impossible task. Tapsell and Layton still lead Class A. Roberts is improving his position and is in the same lap as the leader. The unruffled Moffat still restrains his nod. His fastest lap, 2:55. Lapping practically the whole field, Moffat's lead over McPhee has been narrowed as the Fords continue their dominance. Is right on schedule for his final pit stop, during which the crew makes their fastest turnaround. They've taken no longer than 2 minutes 45 on any stop, but this one, with fuel and four tires, is only 2 minutes 9 seconds. Moffat is cruising less than half a minute ahead of McPhee as the race reaches its closing stages. Roberts recaptures third place from Chivers with some attacking driving. But almost immediately after going over Skyline, Roberts' car spins and crashes backwards down a steep slope. Officials and spectators rush down to render assistance, but although the car is a write-off, fortunately, Roberts is only dazed. Moffat rounds Forest Elbow and heads for Conrod Strait for the last time. He leads McPhee and goes on to win from his teammate, with Don Holland third, a lap behind. Ford's manager Al Turner gives credit to all in the Ford team.
They drove exactly the way we wished them to drive. It's a team effort. It's been a team effort all the way through, and we're very proud of the result. But I must say this, I think it's firstly a credit to our product to do this, and secondly, to the fine group of fellows that worked for me.
My favorite Ford was, funnily enough, the very first Ford that I drove to victory in 1970. We were quite concerned as a team whether we could execute the strategy correctly, because it was my first solo drive, and 6.5 hours around Bathurst was an awful long haul with its own peculiar requirements. But I had a great team and some fabulous pit stops, and were able to get my first victory in 1970. I did enjoy that.
Phil Barnes co-drives with Bob Skelton. John French, backup driver to Moffat. Fred Gibson in the third Works Falcon. Gold Star champion Leo Gagan. Bob Beasley and Bob Muir share one of the 9 Charger entries. The only full-time professional in the race, Alan Moffat, with Ford marketing director Keith Horner. Bob Morris drives one of the 13 Falcons. Harry Firth masterminding the Holden dealer team. 1969 co-winner Colin Bond and David Mackay. In with a strong chance is Des West. Tension approaches its peak. In a few seconds, the 60 starters will be on their way.
1971, and everyone's hopes were dealt a crushing blow. In the first practice session on the mountain, Alan Moffat hurled the new Falcon around at an incredible 13.2 seconds under the 1969 lap record, with the other Ford Works car driven by John French 3 seconds behind him. And the rest? Nowhere. The Ford camp was absolutely jubilant.
Moffat powers up mountain straight, already out on his own. Unleashing its newly developed power, Moffat accelerates the GTHO to something around 140 miles per hour down Conrod. French also has his foot down. Into pit straight, and Moffat sets about dictating the pattern of the race. Driving at a speed to suit himself, Moffat is able to conserve his car, which is responding to every demand. But with the race not yet 5 laps old, the Holden Dealer Works car of Colbond is the first of the fancied entries to strike trouble. The Falcons increase their margin over the smaller cars, who, whilst having a cornering advantage, are outsped on the straights. A straying cardboard carton attaches itself firmly to Moffat's radiator, which is certain to cause apprehension in the Ford pit. Marsden talks of taking immediate action.
Yes, it's surprising what can happen in motor racing. The best prepared cars can pick up a cardboard box. So we're just looking at it now. We'll possibly pull him in very quickly, pull it off and get him straight out again.
Running in fourth place in the John Newell entry is Bill Brown. At McPhillamy Park, a burst tyre on Brown's car causes the most horrifying crash ever witnessed at Bathurst. Bill tells how it happened.
As I come over the blind approach to McPhillamy Park corner and speed in excess of 100 miles an hour, a tyre burst on the car, causing it to veer straight ahead into the bank. And I was a bit worried, you know, for the crowd's sake, that the car would sort of jump the fence and end up in amongst the people. It was just crashing and glass breaking and banging and carrying on. When the car finally came to rest, I was still conscious, and Tatus ran over and they started to tip the car up. I yelled out to them to stop, smell petrol, and I asked, you know, if anyone's smoking, would they kindly leave. By this time, the crash truck had arrived, and I knew everything was all right. Myself, I felt one of my legs was caught. I didn't know what was going on there, because at the time, the back of the seat had broken, and I was laying down flat in the car, luckily for me. And I suppose I've been there for 5 or 6 minutes, and they finally got me out. I had a look at the car and then I went to Bathurst Hospital.
Fortunately, Brown's injuries were only of a minor nature. At Forest Elbow, Leo Gagan and Doug Whiteford brush with spectacular results.
We have a time at about 1 minute 50, and for that we have put on at least 30 gallons of fuel and done 4 complete tyres. He's a very happy man. Every time he comes by, the smile gets bigger.
Consolidating his grip on the classic, Moffat has his rivals struggling to keep within range. Moffat has an advantage of almost 2 laps, and barring misfortune, is assured of victory. Barnes and Skelton have taken over second place, and Mackay is close behind. Concentration inflexible, Moffat is in no danger of becoming complacent. Bond is now fourth behind the Falcons of Skelton and Mackay, running second and third respectively, but they're all too far back to threaten Moffat. On Conrod, in the last of the 130 laps, Moffat is a happy man as he approaches Murray's Corner.
After 500 miles, I can assure you this is the happiest turn a driver can make, is this left-hander onto the straight, waiting for the jubilation of his pit crew to give him the wave of finishing the race.
Moffat's nearest opponent is over a lap behind, and his overall time of 6 hours, 9 minutes, 49.5 seconds betters the previous record by over 20 minutes.
It was the beginning of my association with Carlton United. I didn't even know it was there. One of the greatest facets of Ford engine in the 351 form, 351 cubic inches that is, was that it could run extremely hot and not really be bothered at all. And even in those days, I don't recall how fast we were coming down Conrad, but it was 150 plus miles an hour. And as such, the cooling was superb. The cars always had the heavy-duty radiator in a way that's part of the air conditioning option which was ever was available through the company. And they gave me a sign that said, radiator block. And I just waved to Peter Jeffrey, who was my chief mechanic at the time, and said, don't worry, gauge is hardly moved. We weren't in radio control, naturally. And it was amazing how it stuck on there. A lot of people thought, oh, well, it was one of those.
The flag should be dropping any moment.
And the Bathurst Enduro had never been run in the rain. But it was raining steadily when the flag dropped on Sunday morning. Moffat desperately wanted a hat-trick of wins, but the black-eyed Brock, whose awareness of exactly what a road surface does for a car's handling is without peers, rolled his car to the grid, knowing that the Toranas were much happier in the wet than the big Fords. Let's pick it up with the course commentary.
Battle of the big three and Moffat leading at the end of lap one. Second is French. Brock is next in the Toranas, which means Gibson and Goss have slipped back in their Falcons. Bond is third, then Moore. XL Bendigain, where you saw them come over the hump in a wall of spray. Moffat, closely followed by French. A slight gap to Brock in the first hold. Then Bond and Moore with their lights on. And Brock's got him, slipped through on the run down to Forest Elbow. Moore's looking for a way past two. The Falcon's definitely slower across the top where it's treacherously slippery. Moffat will pull out the stops down the straight. Now let's see who leads past the pits. Yes, it's Moffat again. He might be taking it easy up the top, but on the straight, he's giving the V8 all it's got.
What's this prank? The car rolls side to side, and right at the finish, he's completely upside down and hanging in midair. Look right on the top. Crunch.
Moffat's spot. He's up a bank at Reed Park, near where Bond went. That's two quick body blows to Ford. Gibson crashes, and now Moffat in trouble. That puts Brock and the Holden Toranas into first place. The French has caught into the pitch with tyre trouble. The Works Toranas has hit the number one slot. There's Moffat and Moore in close company. Moffat's still in second, Moore holding down third place. They're bringing Peter Brock in for his first pit stop. It's lap 47, and it should take about a minute and a half to change tyres and take on a full load of fuel. He's still holding first, but this is where he could lose the lead. Shivers, driving a consistent race and holding off from making a pit stop, is in third. French is holding down fourth. And here comes Moffat. He's got the boot down, in fifth and climbing back. Gagan has pitted. Brock's back in the lead, but we've just heard that he's also been penalised a minute for a refuelling miscue. Moffat's in for his second stop. He's got to within 12 seconds of Brock, but the stop will drop him back another 2 minutes. So, to be with Brock at the flag, he's going to have to drive even harder. Let's watch this stop. There's Brock, the leader, still nicely out in front, but French is closing the gap, although he's still got that one pit stop to go. And here's drama, an unscheduled stop by Moffat. Last time in, he was complaining about the Falcon's brakes, and this could be the reason for him bringing the car in so soon. Yes, it looks as though the mechanics are checking out the system. No effort to change tyres. No one's worrying about topping up the fuel tank. And I'd say that this stop could develop into a lengthy one. That'll mean the end of Moffat's chances of taking the 500 from Brock. Look at this. The race is just about run, and drama in front of the pits. Murray Carter has put his Falcon into the fence at Murray's, and he doesn't know that the bodywork is ripping into the tyre. He'll be lucky to get around the track, and he has to do that. Regulations say he can't back up. Carter's made it in. Look at that tyre, shredded to pieces, and look at that battered bodywork. Mechanics are rushing in to get him out on the track again, because Carter has the capacity to finish around about 10th. Driven a sure and steady race. Must be galling to be sitting in the pits like this, with mechanics tearing at the car. And they're hacking at it, too. There's no time for niceties now. There's some bodywork in the road, so the mechanics are chopping it off. It's the quickest way. There's a good look at the ruined tyre. The Holden dealer's team pit is making certain that Brock realises that French is in the runner-up slot, and that as long as the purple Falcon doesn't pass him, he's got the 500.
Thank you. 1973 sees the white and blue Superbirds of the Ford Works team in the hands of Gibson Seaton and Moffat Gagan. But there were only three other Falcons compared with 17 XU1 Tyrannas.
And so they climb Mount Panorama for the first of 162 times. 1,000 kilometres of torture for man and machine in a classic race that is like no other. An enduro in the fullest sense of the word. A supreme test that would expose the full range of human emotions. From the elation of a win to the pain of a loss. From happiness to despair. From laughter to tears.
Last time. Yes, and it's Goss, Moffat, French, Gibson, and Brock, who's very close to the big V8s. It's a cracking pace. They're really standing on the anchors to slow them for Murray. Tight and a trap for the bull, sure unwary. Round they go. Goss, Moffat, French, Gibson, Brock. It's a terrific sight as they fly past the pit. One lap down, 161 to go. The pack's in full cry, setting a fast and furious pace.
Moffat and Gibson close together. Then French, with Brock right on his hammer, he can't shake the Tyrannus. It's Gibson, he's out. Look at that smoke, I'd say the engine's cooked from the hot pace. The duel between Moffat and Brock is now for outright honors, and it's particularly vital for the Ford driver to hold the coveted number one slot, because he'll be pulling in for fuel and tyres soon, and every second counts.
Looking down towards Murray, and it's Moffat, but Brock is only a second behind. Something's got to give, someone's got to crash. And one thing's for sure, it won't be Brock.
Oh, what? Brock's got him into XL, and Moffat's all out of line. Oh, look, there he goes, it's a big 180.
And Moffat's coming straight in. It's a wise move, he might have cracked spotted a tyre, because that was a vicious spin. Going on might cause a blowout. Right now, according to the feed coming back, there's Shivers, confirmed as leader, but Ian Gagan, who's driving like a demon, has hauled right up on his tail.
Up the top, Ian Gagan has taken Shivers.
Is it too late? The Tyrannas have stripped away some of the leader's buffeting margin as they go past the pits for the second last time on their way up the mountain. The gap between Moffat and Brock is down to less than a minute, but motorsport, as the lead Tyranna running out of fuel has shown, follows no set rules. There's still time for fate to play a role when Brock reels from a sudden and cruel blow. Moffat, perilously close, avoids the whirling debris from a crashed Mazda, and with it, the threat of paralyzing mechanical danger. He escapes from the carnage. While for Brock, blue smoke and the screech of tortured rubber signals a shattered tyre. Nothing can catch Moffat now. Victory is his. Brock and the wounded Tyranna fight to the finish. At least he knows he cannot be beaten for second, while Bond, his teammate, is secure in third. So Moffat and Ford take the Hardy Ferodo 1000 crown as a jubilant Howard Marsden sees his winner home.
Number five from the second row of the grid. John Goss will try and spear through. He makes a pretty good start.
1974. And by now, motor racing followers were totally polarized, to the point that you were either a Ford Falcon lover or a Holden Tyranna lover.
The big Falcon are going hard with Bobby James, but it's the Falcon in second spot. And Bond has a long lead as they go for the first of 163 times up Mountain Straight. And the Falcon of Goss showing its great power there as it goes out after Bond. Meantime, at the head, it's still Bond, the number two for the Holden dealer team. Way in front, braking now as he comes down towards Pitt Straight. Fast line, he's really flying in this SLR 5000. Colin Bond, a long gap back to Peter Brock.
And into the pits goes Alan Moffat in car number 33. Alan Moffat into the pits now, as in third position. He's got lots of troubles, apparently.
And the bonnet up. That's the same engine that they fitted second yesterday. It could be anything at the present stage. There's no point in guessing. John Goss now got a tremendous opportunity to carry the Ford flag all the way home. He's the only one that's got any opportunity now. I think Moffitt's race is run to a certain extent. Murray Carter is not in contention. But on the other hand, in such a short time already, Peter Brock is leading this race. He's over 1 minute and 17 seconds ahead of John Goss.
We're back in the race, even though he has lost something like a quarter of an hour in the pits, is Alan Moffat in 33.
John Goss is still carrying the Ford flag pretty well. He's quite a way back, but he's well placed to do well if something goes wrong with those two leading cars. This would be a race that John Goss would dearly love to win. He's been trying for 5 years, and this is undoubtedly the main race on the Australian calendar. He'd love to knock it off. Goss is probably the most popular driver competing here today at Mount Panorama.
Pit straight, we've got a real problem if we can get down there with the cameras. That's Alan Moffat, suddenly discovering he's got barely got a motor and desperately tried to get his car across the other side of the track and back to his pit group, which he's gone past. He's stopped on the outside, as you can see, of the pit row itself. He can't go back against the race direction of traffic.
Nor is he allowed to cross the line under the threat of possible disqualification. All he can do is get into the back area of the pit.
And Brock is in far more trouble than ever Colin Bond has been in. That's pouring out his exhaust pipe. And the crowd is starting to cheer and to go mad. The 20-deep crowd on pit straight waving their arms in unison.
A sad sight for the Holden deal team as car one heads for the back of the pit. So Peter Brock is out of the race. Alan Moffat out of the race, but still joining in the spirit of the things as he tries to get help for John Goss to get him out there, because Forbes and Nagus are closing bit by bit. We've never had a finish like this at Bathurst. And in the lead is Kevin Butler, the old hand of racing. So badly injured earlier this year in a race at New Zealand. Who would have thought he'd have recovered from those terrible injuries to be in a car leading Bathurst in the closing laps of the race? What exciting laps. Talking of excitement, things still happening. Cars spinning on the circuit here.
There it is. One lap to go. 6.2 kilometres.
And Ford still in pursuit. Car four. Been a gallant effort. Had a spin or something which slowed him down. He's dropped back a little bit. And Kevin Bardon only has to finish now to win the most prized race in all of Australia, a unique event. A marvellous challenge from Forbes and a tremendously well-judged, well-driven, well-prepared race by Goss, by Bartlett and by their team manager, Max McLeod. Forbes in full flight for the final time on Conrod Strait. A great effort.
It is Kevin Bartlett who takes the chequered flag to win the 1964 Hardy Proto 1000 for John Goss. And it's an elated John Goss in the pit who at last has won the Hardy Proto 1000.
This was going to be the fastest and the hardest 5-5-1000 ever run at Bathurst. Away they go.
1975, and this year the great race was the winner. And regulations were really spoiling the Falcons' chances.
He positions himself behind Bond, runs through the corner as the rest of the field gets underway and runs and streams down the straight cleanly, all trying to find a safe position.
And a big start by John Goss, who came way up to be right alongside Alan Dreyce there and is jostling for a place. He doesn't want to be too far back despite being on 10th place in the grid.
Oh, and already so many troubles in the pits. Jim Richards has had problems in the New Zealand Holden, but look at them going down the straight. You can almost see the gap there as we pull back. You'll see the distance between the two cars. It's you can see now how the Falcon is certainly catching up to Bond, so there's no doubt who's got the legs. Alan Moffat was saying he was building the car for down the straight. Now he may be outbraked, but let's see it side by side. Bond is going a little later. He'll take a very difficult line on the outside. Moffat is not going to let him through. In fact, he closes up again because he knows he's got the line and he's going to shoulder Colin Bond out of it if he possibly can. And now it's all acceleration up to the line. This is only third lap and already it is neck and neck, side by side. Imagine the cheer from the crowd. It is Bond who's got the better gearing and has more acceleration, and it is Brock who's behind, who's closed on them both. But first in this time and being so close to Bond's nose is Moffat around the bend. And now Alan Moffat leads the race, and Peter Brock pulls out and decides that he might like to lead for a change, and he goes up on the outside of Colin Bond.
Meantime, the hapless Alan Moffat is slowing down again, looking as though he's heading towards the pits. Led the race early on, just passing the Alan Grice vehicle that was involved in a collision with another car there, and has been parked there from the early stages. And Moffat takes the car into the pits.
You can see him.
You can see there the way he's working the steering wheel and the way the wheels are lying over. He's got a real problem there at the side.
Earlier in the day, obviously, we were pushing 155, 160 miles an hour. Now, fortunately, I felt this. A less experienced driver would have said, oh, well, I've just got a puncture, and bang, he would have been into the Armco or off the track, worse still. Colin's in front of me, you know, two of the best prepared teams in Australia, and we're sitting here in the pits fixing things which we just take chances with.
That's it, the checkered flag for Peter Brock
in the 1975 Hardy Frodo 1000 at Baffert.
1,163 laps to go.
1976, and this year will be remembered for two things. Jack Brabham did not get off the starting grid.
Oh no!
And only three teams were running Falcon GTs. Alan Moffat and Vern Schuppen had done well to take pole from Brock, but Moffat's race was to last only 87 laps.
It's deeper into the corner that Moffat is going. Moffat, going for a later braking mark. You can see the gap himself. And with the wipers on already, a bit of a wave from the car with still cold tyres. And for the first time, it will be Alan Moffat using up all the road. A much tighter line by Colin Bond, and he is going to snatch the lead. Moffat right at the end of the pit row, as you can see, up to position number 9.
He's in the pits, and he's getting out of the car, and a very furious-looking Alan Moffat it is too.
And it's John Fitzpatrick through the bend, the car still driving. And he waves, he's got the checkered flag, and it's John Fitzpatrick who wins for the Ron Hodgson team. And in the pits, can you imagine the elation that's going on in there?
Bobby Morris, he's just too upset to know whether to laugh or to cry or what to do.
1977 was the first time that two-way radio communications were used, and the General was to be publicly humiliated. The result certainly spurred GMH into pumping more money into the Holden dealer team.
He just rubbed his shoulders around the outside of Hell Corner. A smaller car still pouring on the track. An Escort has stopped up there, and oh, there's a waggle from the Gemini that just dodges him.
Over the top of the mountain, and here's Grice at speed with Alan Moffat tucked in behind him, and the Ford fans on the top of the mountain are going wild. They want Moffat to pull out and pass down through this very demanding part of the circuit on the approach to the S's. And from our helicopter position, you can see the distance between these two cars.
This is a phenomenal pace for a 1,000-kilometre race. Grice and Moffat dicing. Bond is close right up. You can see how close he is now, right on the tail, and he'll make a move to get by them both.
Well, Grice is going to have his hands full halfway down Conrod Strait because he tries to get out of the corner and then run as hard as he can. Brock taking a very wide line here. The two Fords are going for a bit of slipstreaming, and you'll notice both of them are about ready to attack Alan Grice here on the outside, halfway down Conrod Strait. Moffat pulls out, takes him on the outside, and we'll wait and see whether Grice will try and race him into the braking area.
He'll take Bond with him though, Mike, and Bond is moving into second place, and that'll drive the Ford fans crazy with excitement.
Here they come, but Grice is going to fight back on the inside of Colin Bond. Bond continues on. He's going very hard down the outside. Some team tactics here from Moffat and Colin Bond. Effectively letting Bond through for the lead, and that was a very good manoeuvre. Bond will now lead, and the fans down here in Pitt Street are going to go wild with enthusiasm. And up go the arms as Colin Bond leads Alan Moffat and Alan Grice further back, then on the outside to Peter Brock, then John Harvey, and then, of course, the Gagan Jane car. I wonder what's going through Alan Moffat's mind at the moment as he leads the charge for the $100,000 Hardy Ferrado race this year. With Colin Bond, his teammate, settled back in second place.
His car into pit number 2, right at the start there. You can see the tyres ready for a change. He went a little bit beyond where they expected. The taller figure of Alan Hamilton now looms into sight outside the door, helps unbuckle Colin Bond.
And I think a very, very frustrated...
Worth noting, the commentary team of the day wrote off Alan Moffat.
Well, I think it's a very bad sign, and I'd say the chances of Alan Moffat winning this event now are almost negated, because there's one, there's no way that you can finish the event like that, and two, there's very little doubt that they could, in fact, change the tyre.
A very dramatic finish, and it always seems to be this way with the Hardy Frodo 1000. There is the race leader, Alan Moffat, leading down Conrod Strait. The next car that we should see will be Colin Bond, hopefully. There's not a great deal between them.
Moffat, with Jackie Hicks, his co-driver, has covered 159 laps. This will be his 160th. Bond, the same number of laps. He has Alan Hamilton alongside him. One lap down, Peter Jansen and Larry Perkins. So it's the two Fords up front and a group of surviving Turanas behind.
They're very excited about this, and just look at the reaction to the Fords up the top of the mountain with Colin Bond just sitting in, not making any attempt to manoeuvre. He's playing it strictly to instructions, and this is the final half lap of the 1977 Hardy Ferrado 1000 Classic from Mount Panorama, with Alan Moffat virtually in a limping Falcon with a problem that the team won't tell us about, and Colin Bond driving to orders, just sitting in behind the boss, and that's the way he's going to run out this race.
Without doubt, my greatest moment at Bathurst was the 1-2 finish with my teammate Colin Bond in our XC Falcons. it's hard enough to get one car to the line, let alone to finish the race with a checkered flag on over your bonnet. But to do that with two cars was an enormous effort, which required planning for years and years. It really took almost 4 years to culminate in that victory in 1977.
Moffat in car one. For the last time, they come down in that magnificent view from the 7 helicopter, a scene we've never seen before. Side by side, Colombon Marsley in front. But he'll ease up for the corner and let his team leader through, I would think. But he's in front at the moment. He's going to have trouble braking here to let Moffat through again. Now he does. And Moffat from the outside will sweep around and take the checkered flag first for victory in the 1977 Hardy Ferodo 1000. The winning pair, Alan Moffat and Jackie X.
In 1978 saw the Ford dealers step in to support Moffat.
And side by side on the first lap is the two Falcons in front. The Fords are at it again. They finished this way last year. They want to start this way again. And it's Moffat and Bond side by side as they go spearing up Mountain Straight. Alan Grice, who led at the start of the first lap last time, it is Colin Bond. And wait for the roar of the crowd as they see the Fords in front. They're a partisan mob divided fairly evenly to hold among Falcon teams. And the Falcon supporters will go mad when they see Bond leading Alan Moffat.
Here they come through the top part of the mountain and just wait for the roar as the roaring Fords run 1-2 in the opening lap of the 1978 Hardy Ferodo. Here they come into view now, and the crowd going wild with excitement as they steam past and now down towards the S's. Through the haze, down towards the end of Colombon Straight. No, it's not a repeat of last year's race. It's the start of the 78 race with Colin Bond and Alan Moffat and Bob Morris standing on the gas as he comes down the inside. And Moffat tries to poke down on the inside of Colin Bond, but Morris has won the jump. Wait for the crowd reaction. Into the left hand and now back onto pit straight. The Ford side by side. Morris sideways, but he leads. The first lap completed. And he's taken the first lap prize, but Bond at the inside of him. And Brooke has now moved up on the inside. And we're running 1, 2, 3, 4. Have we got a race going here, folks? On the outside through the turn, and Morris has thwarted a bit there, approaching the side of the door, and leads once again, but he's got Fords all around him.
Sensational stuff, and I don't know how Morris controlled it. He was hit, put sideways, got it back under control, and this is desperate stuff. 162. Rock pulling out as he's spearing down the straight. The radar trap showed the fastest car first time through was Pete Gagan.
The radar finally Alfred was also on the pits. Patrick Mee were there.
Okay, here we have the race lead change with Peter Brock, Australian touring car champion, taking over the front running. Bob Morris is back in second, and tailgating is Alan Moffat in car number one.
Whether he can leave his braking late enough, whether he's prepared to, I don't think so. He'll be happy to stay there, maybe close up a little bit under brakes. So it's Alan Moffat who, for the first time, leads the race.
Very, very talented all, and Harvey decides he's going for broke. The inside will do. Wait for this. This puts Harvey wisely elected to just ease off the throttle, and
he's taking him up the mountain.
Oh, the car's on fire.
Oh, look at Alan Moffat.
The car's on fire. Alan trying to put the fire out himself with the towel that he was using earlier.
One of the Ford dealer team pit crew, is it?
What caused the fire, Alan?
Oh, well, I'd say CAM's regulations would be a good starting point. Maybe somebody will wake up when we burn one of these cars to the ground that we can get the dry brake system to prevent that. I don't know what started it, but it's the fact that we're vulnerable to this sort of thing.
The X has lost it. Jack X has either had a lose
there he
up is. Here.
Yes, he just overran that. Maybe he's having trouble with the brakes. He might just not have settle in, and he cannot get reverse gear. Now he's got it. Now if he gets locked in reverse, which happened to the car when it was in the pits, no, he doesn't. He's right back on the track again, and Jackie X getting a great cheer from the crowd, some of whom think it's probably Moffat.
The checkered flag unfolds for the 1978 champion, Peter Brock.
After 163 laps, Peter Brock, winner of the great race.
1979, and this was the last racing year of the XC Falcons and the Toranas. Both Holden and Ford withdrew their involvement from racing, but you only need to look at the pre-race race form to realise that this was going to be a damn quick race.
Zooming up Mountain Straight. And here is our camera view in the Peter Williamson car in the small leader class. This is what it feels like in the opening corner and the first run to Mountain Straight. Oh, went sideways, Dick Johnson. Alan Grice making this big bowl move on Alan Moffat coming up here in this pack, and John Harvey was making forward progress very speedily. If you remember, Harvey started position 11, was unhappy that Moffat got a shot from the second row, and Harvey has gone through. Dick Johnson has inverted the Ford, the Brian Bird Ford, in a very, very tough place, and that's going to cause
Dick's doing the car too. The got into the fence there.
Oh, bad luck indeed. This is the Ron Wanless Leo Leonard Denmark Ford entry from Queensland. Leo Leonard was to have started and carried out the first driving stint. And
I think he might have carried out the last driving stint, but look at that
stall. Troubles for John Fitzpatrick. The Alan Moffat Falcon is in trouble.
Moffat had a great-looking Falcon, but the team retired the car with only 135 laps on the board.
The thing I hate most is seeing it on that vulture carrier, if you want to know the truth. That's really the sad part. I wish they'd leave them on the track.
Listen to the crowd warming up. A checkered flag unfolds a page in history as Peter Rock in the Marlboro Holden dealer team comes across to take the checkered flag.
The 1980 Bathurst race can be perceived as some kind of watershed. It was the debut of the Commodore, and Alan Moffat, the Ford hero of the 70s, had his last start in a Falcon. But a new Ford driver was on the scene. Dick Johnson proved that the Falcon XD and Commodores were fairly evenly matched.
And he's got a long lead, and Brock is after him.
And Bartlett now up into third place after that run up the mountain.
Well, that shows the legs of the Camaro. He made up a lot of ground and passed three cars going up there, just in front of Johnny Harvey. Then it's Alan Grice next, who made a good start and is perfectly positioned. But it's Dick Johnson from Queensland, who for the first time draws the cheers of the crowd, and the Ford flags are out as they come flying up the top of the mountain on lap one of the Hardy Ferrari 1000 for 1980.
Wait for the cheers from the crowd as they come across the top of the mountain on lap one of the great race for 1980, the Hardy Ferrari 1000. You'll be able to see the spectators absolutely placards waving, standing there cheering because a Ford's going to lead the first lap of this race. Back onto Conrod Straightaway. Watch the AFCO Pepsi Camaro pull out. He's had enough of it. Dixon wants to get out of the way because Moffat, I don't think, will last another lap or so without getting the black flag.
But things aren't going well his way. And, of course, we have Kevin Bartlett with even earlier troubles with his...
Oh, we've had another bang. And is that the
Dick
race?
Johnson. Dick Johnson. Now, whether Dick has been hampered by the rescue truck here, which is out on the track, but he has gone into the fence. Dick Johnson, the leader, he's broken the left-hand front suspension. You can see, by the way, the car is leading down. Now, a rescue vehicle has been out to bring in one of the damaged vehicles. The officials are running back. I rather think that Dick came round the corner and found himself with an impossible situation. You can see them stimulating the flag marshal, saying, for heaven's sake, wave the flags. There's Bobby Morris just came in, almost collected the front of the car, and the field is pouring through. The marshals are out now, waving down, trying to slow things. There's a rescue truck there. Johnson, the race leader, is out of the race.
Post-race investigations reveal that Dick Johnson's demise was caused by a projectile being thrown at Dick's car by a thoughtless spectator.
It's been a tough day for equipment here at Bathurst.
Won't be too long before these flags come out. Here it comes, the checkered flag for Peter Brock and Jim Richards. Richards at the wheel. A great finish.
1981.
1,000. Johnson's and flying. It's Dick Johnson of Queensland, who leads from Kevin Button going into the first turn. And just look at that wall of cars.
81 fulfilled the promise that the Ford versus Holden battle was the most evenly matched since 1976.
It is an incident-free first corner.
Dick Johnson, racing the Falcon XD, sometimes referred to as the people's car because of last year's incident, looked like winning the flag.
On the gas, Dick Johnson, but Bartlett is coming to him as they speed up Mountain Straight. Now the brake duel. Whoa! Not much between them. There was almost a touch.
Bartlett's over the strip on the inside.
Boy, Dick Johnson wants to lead this in a hurry, and Brock says, let's make it three wide and have a real race of it.
Brock takes the inside run.
Oh.
Johnson's lost out in this battle. Bartlett maintains the lead. Brock is through to second.
Okay, Brock is now going to put the pressure on. I think Brock wants to get up there in front and run. Johnson says, hey, I was up there a minute ago. He's going back after it. The comparison of speed along going up the mountain straight between the Ford and the Commodore. This is pretty racy stuff in the opening laps. Kevin Bartlett is attacking the first five laps as though he was going for pole position again.
After two laps, Laurie Nelson's Capri on the pits. Look at his nose to tail, and Bobby Morris is slipping right into the back of Dick Johnson. Oh, he might lose out on the corner here, I think. The right-hander.
Look at this.
There's a definite touch. Bartlett's lost something.
Deary me. Okay, oh, deary me, Brock, I think, has got problems, has he? He's pulled to the outside, and Bartlett, Brock is, I think, in trouble. Yes, he's been passed by Kevin Bartlett. Goes back into the race lead. Johnson is in second place.
Bobby Morris third.
1981 XD Falcon was a terrific motor car. It was very well balanced.
Queensland with Dick Johnson, the man from Prudential, leading this quite nicely. We have an enormous traffic jam. We've had a horrendous crash at the top of the mountain. By the look of it, Bobby Morris at number 7 is around sideways. 57 is there, one of the recar team cars. We have an absolute blocked track at the top of the mountain.
There's the view from Alan Grice's car. He's there, car 44. He's just stopped. He's not in damage, but there are a number of cars. Bob Morris's car is there. Bob Morris going so hard trying to get up the lead in second place.
The track is completely blocked. A replay of it for you.
Well, Christine Cole is involved. She was very early there. You can see Christine on the left. Bob Morris came along. He spun there, the car going backwards. Christine was involved first with another car. There are cars on the other side. Alan Brown.
With the decision on the fate of the race from the Australian Racing Drivers Club, Ivan Stibbard.
And the regulations say that after 60% of the distance has been covered and the red flag is used, the race must be declared. We cannot have a restart.
Well, that means that Dick Johnson is the winner under those conditions?
Yes.
Probably the biggest moment would have to have been 1981 when I won Bathurst for the first time.
1982. This time, there were only two classes, over and under 3 litres. And the Falcon XE, a great car, was proving very hard to handle around the track.
As all the cars make their way into the first left-hand corner.
Moffat has made a great start, but it's gone wide. So are many cars trying to consolidate their positions. And it's a mad scramble on the first lap up Mountain Straight.
Brock trying to get past Grice as they go up the mountain.
Dick Johnson running in fifth place, heading this third group through. Close behind him, John Harvey. Then we have Alan Moffat. Up through the cutting, the steepest part of the track, a 1-in-6 grade, very steep there, severe, a hard grind on gearboxes, a full load of fuel.
Oh, he's gone. Kevin Bartlett
is over.
Bartlett has gone. He's got Dick Johnson maybe through. No, Dick got out of the way, but the back tyre is off. James Hardy, 1,000, it goes to Peter Rock.
1983. Amongst the 10 Falcons, only Dick Johnson looked like an outright threat. But with the crash in practice, an almost Herculean effort by a lot of people saw the car rebuilt overnight. But a rebuilt car will never win Bathurst.
Jim Richards then coming back on the inside of Peter Jansen. There's Dick Johnson making a good start too. They head up Mountain Straight for the first time and we have a safe first corner as they head up to GTX Ben.
And there's Johnson now in the green car coming through. Oh, and what a great effort to get that car to the start line. Let's just keep our fingers crossed, hope and pray that he can keep the car going.
Final corner of the James Hardy 1000 for 1983. Down through the gears. He's done it. He's put 7 on the board. Peter Rock wins the 1983 James Hardy 1000 at Mount Panorama.
1984, and the flag dropped on 63 cars, which equaled the record set in 1969 and 1978.
Johnson ranges up on the inside to take over second place as they run to the first corner. Tagging him is Alan Grice, and then Fury getting into stride. The BMW is out wide, and then John Harvey making a good start as well as they stream up Mountain Straight. And there's the view of the entire field as it heads off for the first time up to the mountain and towards GTX Bend.
And here they come. They'll be looking for speeds of 260 kilometres an hour or more. Peter Brock, Dick Johnson go by. There's Alan Grice now. Fury and Moffat. Into the braking section, down through the gears, and Brock is first.
Masterton apparently has just gone into the wall on the rundown, I think, to Forest Elbow.
That is not good news for the Masterton Homes 2WS race team. We'll try and catch up for you and see what has happened here. Coming down, there's English, the last car on screen. He's got into the side of the Clearahan Mazda RX-7. Clearahan's heading out to the wall. He decides he's turning the other way. My goodness me.
Lumps of concrete flying everywhere. Knocked a big hole in the wall.
Our second place man, is that Dick Johnson pulling up?
What's the problem?
Some goddamn thing in the tank, I don't know.
What, you got a fuel blockage?
No, it's not a blockage, mate. It just won't pick it up.
Peter Brock in 05 comes across the line to win the 1984 James Hardy 1000.
1985, and there were only four Fords, the lowest turnout since 1966. And Johnson had snapped up Larry Perkins and was the only one of four to pose an outright threat. The 1985 Great Race is a real classic.
Now they miss the start completely. They head to the first turn where Walkinshaw from Dick Johnson, they all go through and now make their way up Mountain Straight. Down on the inside, Dick's going to have a go, is he? To the left-hander. So Jim Richards takes Johnson.
And John Goss has slipped by Francevic, so it's Jaguar 1-2 again on the track at the moment. Look at this, Johnson on Mountain Straight, puts the boot in. Close enough to have a chat. Dick gives him the thumbs up and a big smile and says, OK, pal, your turn.
But he's got the inside run to the next corner, so Dick loses out on that one.
I've got you covered, Dick. Dick lets him go.
Dick Johnson has some problems here with the number 17 car blowing smoke.
Jilly, I'll have to come in.
Johnny Goss is going to engineer the 1-2 JRA Jaguar finish to Australia's Great Race. Chalk up one. John Goss, the winner of the James Hardy Classic for 1985.
1986 sees Dick Johnson and Greg Hansford in the Ford Mustang and the first race of the Ford Sierra.
There's Gricey chopping straight into the left-hander. And so beautifully he takes it through there as they head up Mountain Straight for the first time. The field goes through without an incident in the first corner. We've got a safe start to the 1986 James Hardy Classic as they head up Mountain Straight towards Bridgestone Corner. Just look at the field sweeping. Gricey, all the way to the floor, leads the Turbo Nissan of Gary Scott. Larry Perkins running in third place. George Fury is fourth. And you can wait as they go through Bridgestone Corner and work their way up to the BP cutting for the reaction as Australia's Commodore leads the Turbo Challenge across the mountain for the first time.
Hey, there's Dick Johnson. We really haven't sighted Dick for the most part, but he's not in too bad a shape. In about eighth position on the track at the moment, seventh in fact, and making a strong... Oh, hello.
Francevic in trouble again in car 40. What a disastrous day for the big Kiwi.
Well, they've been plagued right from the moment the flag dropped. They've been in and out of the pits no less than three times.
This race is like the Irishman that won the Tour de France, I tell you. He had to go on a lap of honour.
Now, what's the shape of the car like after you've got back in? Has Greg looked after it for you?
Oh, you better believe it, mate. She's brand new.
He's a good operator.
Yeah, he's a good operator. The water temperature's no different. The oil temperature's still the same.
We didn't get a chance to do any split times on him, but how competitive was he with your times?
Yeah, he was doing 23s and 24s. And boy, is there some oil here.
Yeah, what's the state of the circuit like?
Well, it was all right.
Well, one of your mates in a Ford Mustang, the Anderson brothers, have just spun off into the entrance to the pits.
Well,
and you'll be
right.
Pleased to know that the Wilmington Jansen Jaguar XJS was also in a bit of strife down there.
Now, witness race cam by the best.
Three parts of a lap between first and second, and a further three parts of a lap between second and third.
Coming up to Bridgestone Corner, the pride of Queensland, the top banana, as they say. Dickie Johnson carrying race cam yet again. It's become part of your life, Dick. You've got to pay attention. I was saying race cam really is a part of your life these days.
Yeah, not bad either, mate.
You know, a lot of people keep asking us whether or not having to talk and concentrate at the same time, do your lap times drop off?
No, not really. Maybe a tenth of a second or so. Depends where it is. and what I'm trying to think of, because sometimes the dribble I put in my head doesn't fall out at the right time.
I have the same problem, mate.
I think a lot of journos do, mate.
At least I'll admit to it. I was just thinking that as far as this race is concerned, we're getting down now with probably an hour and five still to run. And I know things can go wrong in a race, and one doesn't really want to talk about things that can go wrong. But if the car is still running there strongly, there's a couple of question marks over a car or two in front of you. You're looking pretty good for maybe a top three finish.
Well, mate, I'm damned if I know, but this is no different now to what it was when we started the race, except that the oil temperature's come down a bit because I've knocked the revs off a bit, and the water temperature's down a little bit. The oil pressure's still the same. We've tipped a heap of oil and it's probably got heaps too much in there. But, you know, I can't fault anything else. Everything else is brand new.
You're trying to tell me it's good to honk with a Henry?
Well, I just hope it keeps honking.
The last corner comes up as Grice and the Chickadee Roadways Commodore V8 hits the last turn, straightens it out. Checkered flag at the ready, and the Aussie privateer, the Battler, cracks it for the Hardy 1000. Racing in the 1987
announced the arrival of the RS500 Sierra, which completely changed Ford's fortunes and racing on the mountain.
Terrible start from him in car 7. There he is behind Peter McLeod at the mobile car number 10 as the field streaks up mountain straight. A dreadful start from Needsvitz.
Beautiful shots as they head up mountain straight, bound for the right-hander at Bridgestone Corner.
Andy Rouse, the leader, as they crest the top and head towards Bridgestone, the right-hander. Very quick, fast, sweeping right-hander. Madiki to second. There's Perkins and Brock. Johnny Cecotto, car number 42, the BMW M3.
Steve Sober got off to a much better start than his Eggenberger teammate, Needsvitz. Sober in third place.
Andy Rouse leads in the ANZ Banking Sierra. Car number 9 as they sweep beneath. Here's them closing up. Andrew Madecki up into second spot. Steve Sober is third. Alan Grice fourth. Larry Perkins is the next one through. Dropping down now through the S's towards the Dipper.
Grice, Perkins and Brock making one heck of a charge up the mountain, but the Sierras have been substantially quicker all week coming down Conrod straight towards the new Caltex chase.
Coming down to Toledo turn for the first time, Andy Rouse of Great Britain. And we'll see whether Soper can pull out of the draft now and pass Madecki as they come up to the top of the roller coaster and down for the first time towards Caltex chase. Here's Soper making his move on the inside. The field goes through. There's an idea of the new-look Caltex chase area. They swing them back towards the Bridgestone Bridge. Here's our track cam. 7 Sport exclusive as the cars go over the top of our camera. And they come down for the completion of the first lap. Here's Soper making a move. Going to put a number on Madecki. That moves him up to second. Rice sits back in fourth. And the Bob Jane T-Marts Commodore as they complete the first lap of the 87 Classic.
There is Dick Johnson in trouble in car number 17.
Doesn't appear to be any damage. It looks like he's just rolled off the circuit with some mechanical problem.
Let's have a look on our Toyota replay of an incident that occurred up here. Larry Perkins.
Pop! And Dirk, I think that's the number 18 Ford Sierra, which was driven by Neville Crichton off the start.
He's made up that gap he lost over the top of the mountain and now sits on the bumper of the Texaco Ford Sierra. And here's the Grouse. Rouse making his move down the outside. Can he do it? Andy Madecki sits back in third spot. Grice just behind him.
They've dropped back to 224.45, which is going to allow... And Soper being passed by Rouse now as they head up towards the top of Mountain Straight. And I don't think Soper's in very good shape at the moment for some strange reason.
Trying to stay with Rouse, but unable to do so. Rouse really made a lightning move there as they came out of Hell Corner. So Rouse has got the lead again, and Soper all that hard work to do once more.
Have you any idea what the problem is with the car at the moment?
Well, I think to stop so suddenly, it would have had to be in the transmission or the diff, but until Andy gets back, we won't be certain.
Yes, here we are, 35, Andrew Madecki in the pits, the race leader. And also Steve Soper is in. So the two top cars in the pit simultaneously. There's Soper, Dieudonné, Pierre Dieudonné now in the car. It's a long way yet to get to the pit lane. Klaus Ludwig behind the wheel, the man who set fastest time. His co-driver, Klaus Niedwitz, started the race. Handed over to Ludwig. They were flying up front, had a commanding lead in the race. Our Motorcraft pit report speaks for itself, as you can see, the frenzied action on behalf of the Eggenberger team. Yep.
Yeah, it looks as if tires, it was a fuel problem.
Fuel and a driver change, so yeah, it must have been fuel. Thank you, Neil Crompton. Nice to see you. Had Pierre Dieudonné with you. I hope you've also got your raincoat with you, because it is about to bucket down at Mount Panorama. Our Seven Chopper pilot, Frank Van Rees, reports very, very heavy showers just the other side of the mountain and heading in this direction.
Take a look at this. This is Mount Panorama Bathurst. We started the day under threatening skies. And this is really going to be a test here for the final hour of the World Touring Car Championship round.
12 seconds gone, and it is torrential down here at the moment. The rain's driving sideways, freezing cold. Steve Soper still in the car. Pierre Dieudonné standing by. And the track is now very, very wet, and it's gale force. Just on 30 seconds was the stop then for Soper. And as you can see, they've gone for a full groove wet tyre.
There's one of the Oxo cars. It's had it. Which one is it? It's 34.
It says 34, yeah.
That's the Giddings car.
Yeah, he's clobbered the side there fairly hard.
And also the pace car is out on the track. Let's go to Neil Crompton.
The yellow flags are out at the moment. I think I just saw the pace car going out. It's actually hailing here at present. It's freezing cold. And we're standing by for the other Texaco Sierra. And if you've ever seen some sensational pit activity, you've never seen anything until what you're going to see in the next few minutes.
Chocotto's car has got some very heavy damage to the front. Here's the reason why the pace car's out.
Just the reason up on the top part of the mountain.
Yes, one of the Toyotas, car number 91. That's the Faulkner entry.
I think it's both of the Toyotas.
Is it
actually Wilcamp?
Yeah, he's got one wheel that's virtually right off.
That's the 24 car, the Bajan Bauquet car in the background, the 91 Toyota, and there's another car here about to get collected.
Oh, wow, that's the Brabham Fangio car.
Yeah.
Well, Soper has a lap plus on his nearest competitors at the moment, and his nearest competitor is teammate Klaus Ludwig in the number 7 Texaco car. Then Johnny Chocotto.
The Texaco Sierra had major problems with fuel. Here's how it sounded live.
There's going to be one very big drama at the end of this race. I just chanced on a story a moment ago about possible illegal fuel in both the Texaco Sierras. Now, I've spoken with a Confederation of Australian Motorsport official, who has taken a sample of the fuel from the vent bottle and also a sample of fuel from their overhead 120-litre refuel compartment. The fuel that came out of the vent bottle blew the hydrometer off the clock. I'll let you read your own rules into that. And the fuel that was taken out of the overhead refuel container, he said, quote, was almost right. So, work it out yourself. At the moment, the lap board says 139 laps. Cars 6 and 7 lead the race. And Peter Brock is in third position in car number 10. But at the end of this racing afternoon, there's going to be a lot of discussion about those two lead cars.
Here's the last lap board now for young Briton Steve Soper as he takes out on the last lap around Mount Panorama for the James Hardy 1000, 1987. Soper swings it back. Has a look over the shoulder. Heads down to Bridgestone Bridge for the final time. And the World Touring Car Championship for 1987 has arrived at Bathurst this weekend. The 1987 James Hardy 1000 will go to Steve Soper of Great Britain in the Texaco Ford Sierra, and he takes the chequered flag. The Australian Television Network welcomes viewers around the world to the 1988 TUI's 1000 from Mount Panorama at Bathurst. The pace car pulls into the pits, and for the first time in history, we're about to have a rolling start to Australia's great race. Dick Johnson, John Bauer. Almost a perfect formation. Klaus Niedwitz will go with them. Longhurst is lagging back. Let's wait for the start, and here they come. The great race is underway. The first TUI's 1000, and it's Johnson away quickly.
1988 and 12 Sierra RS500 start the great race. The car was a white-hot favourite to win. And another first was Peter Brock's defection to BMW and the introduction of a rolling start.
But for just about the completion of the first lap,
And Dick Johnson will get a huge cheer as he comes across the line. He leads a lap one of the Tuohy's 1,000 at Mount Panorama. Tricky Dicky in front, clear of Klaus Niedzwitz and Tony Longhurst. It's a Sierra benefit at the moment. We expected that.
Here's the scrap for second as Tony Longhurst makes a dive on the inside to the Humbin Mountain straight. Niedzwitz under pressure and the B&H car has gone through to second.
Good move from Tony Longhurst. We see Peter Brock coming up here on the inside.
Oh,
hearing me, that
he said, I want you to follow me across McPhillamy Crump and I'll show you how to do it. I think I might throw that out the window. He was lucky to get through the sand there and not get bogged.
Oh! How can you have a lose halfway down Conrod? It's the number 17 car. It's Johnson at the wheel.
He's
tapped the fence. And John Bauer goes through, looks over his shoulder. Can't imagine what's happened. There must be a huge problem with the rear end of the car. He's had a lose at 260 kilometres an hour. His pit was ready for him. And he's been able to get it underway again.
He's had a puncture.
Before he went off the racetrack, he was 7.8, almost 8 seconds clear of Tony Longhurst. All of that has now evaporated. Dick Johnson heads up Motorcraft Hill. Our information is that he has already called in on the radio and told Neil Lowe. As Neil was explaining earlier, the only problem was a puncture. They've got more trouble than a puncture because they've got some violent problems with the car.
It's a vibration of some description.
Now, he's up to 10th.
Look, he's driving pretty gently over the top of the hill. Driving it really gently.
Yeah,
she's got a big vibration, all right.
Johnson, pole sitter for the Tuohy's 1000. Steps out of the car. He has the choice of two other machines, the 18 and the 28 car. This is for the lead in the Tuohy's 1000. Tony Longhurst of Queensland and the Benson and Hedges Sierra being tailed by Klaus Niedzwitz in the number 9 ANZ Sierra. There's Greg Hansford of Queensland, third driver in the ANZ lineup for this weekend. Klaus Niedzwitz has done his stints. Moffat has had a run, kept the pace up of the car, the front of the pack, let it throw out. And now Greg Hansford's time.
Look at the grunt of Tony Longhurst's car as he makes his way up Mountain Straight and goes comfortably by Greg Hansford.
He's unlapped himself there. So he's now on the same lap as the ANZ car.
So all he needs is an accident in the pace car and he's looking good.
And they're in, the Caltex cars are in third and fifth position. So Bond is another one who's gone through an awfully painful period of development with the Sierras. Just when everything looked to be firing, there was a failure. Some gear turbos they had a lot of trouble with, getting tyres just right was another one, suspensions. But it's all come together here at Mount Panorama. Two cars in the top five.
And he's tried so very hard to make a name for himself in Europe. He's running in British Formula 3 alongside the likes of Gary Brabham. Around goes the lusty Commodore.
It's done it.
And he's dropped some, what's he dropped there? Water? She's had the thing must have let go and it's sprayed rubbish all over the rear tyres.
Mazira very wisely just ducked briefly down to the escape road to avoid any possible collision. Smart thinking.
Keep it all crossed, Tony. It's looking good for you at the moment.
He's got the winning grin.
As the last lap board comes out, the race has been going now for 7 hours and 1 minute.
But who's counting?
The heck of a day.
Wait for the reaction. For Thomas Mazira, Tony Longhurst and Frank Gardner. Fans on top of Mount Panorama, saluting them. Down to Forest Elbow. Final time. Officials and the fans up there acknowledge Thomas Mazira as he powers out of there. Heads down Conrod Straight for the final time. For the 1988 Tuohy's 1000 at Mount Panorama at Bathurst, congratulations to Thomas Mazira, the great race winner in our bicentennial year. Frank Garner has finally cracked it, so too has Tony Longhurst, and they deserve it.
Yes, Dickie Johnson in second place, car number 18, after a great drive with John Bauer. And third place is going to go to car number 4 with Alan Jones at the wheel, the Colin Bond Caltex Racing Ford Sierra.
We're only about 10 seconds away from the start of the 1989 Tuohy's 1000. They're racing!
1989, and the main opposition to the Sierras was expected to come from Nissan. And Brocky now drives a Ford. Let's go to the action.
So they go to the first corner and work up Mountain Straight for the first time, but a brilliant start by Peter Brock.
shows the way up towards the mountain as the rest of the field goes through. We haven't had an incident in the first corner. Now they're heading up to the right-hander.
Somebody was out in the dirt halfway up Mountain Straight. There was plenty of rock and roll happening there.
It's Brock in front. Johnson drops into second. Klaus Niedzwitz is third as they go through the right-hander and work their way up Motorcraft Hill.
Brad Jones right on their tail. Andrew Medecki, Jim Richards.
Medecki pulled to the right then. I think he may have a problem.
Slowing.
Over the top of the mountain, and you'll find it's Peter Brock still leading from Dick Johnson. Johnson swings into view through two east turn and across the top of Mount Panorama.
Starting to really work some speed into the car now. And Longhurst now has made it up to fourth place. So he is really charging back through the field.
But what I'm curious about is why he dropped off to begin with. And
started from third, dropped back to 12th.
Good start, got round the first left-hander okay, headed up Mountain Straight, then suddenly seems to drop the ball and is now recovering again.
Looks like they may be pushing the car just forward. There's a couple of other guys to do pit stops, or is it going behind the pit wall? And it looks like that is exactly where it's headed. So Tony Longhurst, the defending race champion of the Tooheys 1000, the 88 winner. Overheating problems for a couple of the Sierras. Not for this one, though. Tricky Dicky of Queensland, who continues to lead the Tooheys 1000. Over the top of the mountain now. On his way down to Skyline. Sweeps it out wide. As we take our Dunlop race cam, we believe it won't be too long before Dick heads into the pits. What a capable co-driver he has in Tasmanian John Bauer. Sensational young driver, runner-up to him in the Touring Car Championship. Bit of a problem there as the second Johnson car was already in, just held him up momentarily. So Johnson out and John Bauer will be in. And he roused down to Forest Elbow. Out of Toledo Tools turn, now onto Conrad Straight. In the Peter Brock Mobil 1 Sierra, car number 05. After earlier problems, they are up to third and can run, I would suspect, this pace all day. Rouse is a noted enduro driver, coming up behind one of the Commodores at the moment. Full tilt across Skyline, down into the S's. This is what really takes your breath away, even if you just drive around the circuit in a new car. Remaining number 20, B&H Sierra.
Still in seventh place, you know, despite all their troubles. Yeah.
Tony's had a run in the car. Alan Jones started off running this car until they had a head gasket problem with Tony's 25 mount.
Peter Brock here, the back right-hand wheel nut is locked on. Those huge pneumatic spanners trying to get it off, and they've had now three of them onto it, just taking them off in succession. And it's locked on good and tight at the moment.
It's major drama there for Peter Brock. The car was up to third.
Won't be much thread left when they do get it off.
No, there won't be. They're still working away, Peter. Must be a terrible feeling to have worked it up into third and just be sitting here in the pits and watching them go by.
Yeah, it's not what I'm paid to do. But not much we can do about it at the moment. I just have to sort of keep it cool and get out there and sort of do my job. The guys have finished the pit stop. They were changing these wheels the other day at about 9 seconds. It seems that it's about 9 minutes at the moment.
Problems here for Alain Ferte in car number 35, the Peter Jackson Sierra.
It's a tricky manoeuvre. Gary Wilmington gets through.
That's a really dangerous spot.
The marshal shouldn't be... Well, he's not going to push him out of the way there.
No, I'd get out of the way in a big hurry, because when you come over there, there's just no way you can stop the car drifting. I'm sure there'd be double yellow flags out there. But
35 was running eighth with Alain Ferte at the wheel.
Anxious pit crew members. Oh, this is awful! Bagnall goes through.
I guess there's two evils there. Yeah, leaving a car there is also extremely dangerous, but gee whiz.
Glenn Seaton, look at the look on his face.
I know what Dick's had in his rear mirror for the last five or six laps, and that's the front of this Nissan. I don't think Jim could get any closer.
There's another little look here on the inside. Ducks back in again. And I think it'll be just terrific for all our viewers throughout Australia, particularly in Tasmania, to hear from John Bauer. Can you hear us, Johnny?
Yeah, mate, I can hear you. I'm trying to sort of press on a bit because the car's dropped its boost. It's only got about 1.5 bar or something. There's not much I can do about it.
Well, the ANZ car is only about 32, 33 seconds behind you, JB.
Wilco, I'm very aware of that. There's just not much I can do about it. I'm going as fast as this thing will go. And the car itself's perfect. It just hasn't got any grunt.
Yeah.
Gee, that sun's bad. You can't see.
There was a lovely little sign there that said, last lap, John.
Yeah, I know. Wouldn't it be...
Dick, it is going to happen. You are going to win this one with JB. Here comes the crowd reaction to John Bauer driving the Dick Johnson Shell Sierra across the top of the mountain for the final time. Down to Skyline. And John's actually got the hand out the window acknowledging the cheers. That's quite a feeling, John, isn't it?
It's incredible, isn't it? The guys that were barracking for Brockie this morning and were booing us, they were even clapping. Fantastic.
All you got to do is keep breathing.
We started our telecast at 10 this morning with the great race. John Bauer leads us into the last corner. JB, how does it feel? You're the two-east champion for 89.
Unbelievable. Fancy doing that.
You've done it.
That's incredible, an incredible feeling.
Congratulations to you from all the viewers around Australia today. And Dick Johnson has actually broken into a big smile. Australia's great race ready to explode from Mount Panorama Bathurst, Sunday, September 30. And cribbing the line almost was one of the old cars getting away.
1990 was the ultimate test of man and machine as Nissan had posted a record fastest lap at 2:15.46.
Johnson, a very, very poor start.
Can Ford and Holden hang on?
Look at the lead so far as Niedzwitz blitzes them through there. Brock in second. Seaton is your next driver, followed by Longhurst. Then, of course, Greg Hansford moving up smartly, also the second of the Dick Johnson car. So we've had a great start.
We have. This was made in heaven for Klaus Niedzwitz, but poor Dick Johnson. I think I don't think he gave it enough revs at the start. The car bogged down and he almost got hit from behind. Niedzwitz is not letting Jim Richards get away and tries to get around the outside there as they come over Nissan Skyline. That's not the place to do it, is it, mate?
Definitely not.
Peter Brock, still driving a Ford, enters the pits.
Oh, in the pits. Peter Brock, 0-5. Team are already down there. Not surely the same.
This can't be happening 2 years running. They had a problem last year with that right rear hub. Locking the nut was locked on, and it looks to have happened again. There's problems there for the Brock team. They've got the nut off now, but this is a long pit stop. He was in third position, and this will drop him way down the order.
Some great pictures there. Peter Brock takes it all philosophically. Look at this fantastic view that we're bringing you, our race cam team, with this special camera. Silhouette cam, we like to call it, as we hang it out the side of the Colin Bond Caltech Sierra. He's chasing Glenn Seaton at the moment, putting a lot of pressure on Glenn Seaton as they go across the top of the mountain. You'll see a great view here as they come up to Skyline on a concrete wall. How close would you like it? Drifting out here. Watch the movement of the front wheels now tucking into the left-hander.
The problems there. They're filling up the water tank, in fact, for the brakes, the cooling of the brakes, I think. And Seaton ready to go now. He's been in a little while, but he's off now in a case of just how these tyres are going to go.
And here comes the Moffat machine into the pits. Steve Titmus to call it as Klaus Niedzwitz still in the car.
Yes, he is. Mike, it looks as if at one stage he was going to hop out of the car, but now it looks as if he won't at this stage because he told Frank Biala to go away. And at this stage, there's a lot going on. It looks like they're changing all tyres as usual, and also filling up the oil as well in the motor.
The 25 car is in the pits, and it looks like we have some problems. Tony Longhurst stepping from the car. This looks very ominous. Tony Longhurst, they have a major problem with the Benson and Hedges number 25 car.
Right, push it away quickly.
Frank Gardner, you're
push the car away. Straight over Seven's track cam as they head to the top of the mountain. Here is your race leader, Dickie Johnson, car number 17. Number 9 car running, we believe, in second spot. And car number 16 with Wynn Percy at the wheel running back there in about third.
How's the car feel?
Well, except for the fact that it, as you can hear the whistle that it's got, it's done an, obviously done a compressor wheel, and it wouldn't pull a sick baby off the family pow, actually.
You always had a way with words.
Well, got to have a way with something. We obviously haven't got too much of a way with turbo wheels.
Flap 91 of 161 in the car that was running second on the road, the number 10. ANZ Sierra with Frankie Biela at the wheel is in the pits, and there are a lot of long faces down there, John Brady.
With Miss Klaus needs, which Klaus was about to do a driver change and a brake pad change, the car's up on blocks. Any idea what the problem is, Klaus?
Frank told me there's a noise on the rear axle somewhere out there. Just we have to look for which problem we have.
Mate, geez, your luck just doesn't get any better, does it?
Yeah, it looks really badly, but we still have another car, so...
Thanks, Klaus. And, mate, as you said, a lot of long faces around here at the moment, Michael. They are looking under the back of the car, as Klaus suggested, but no one's moving with a great deal of hurry at the moment. It looks like there's a fairly large problem with it.
The race relentlessly rolls on, but the Sierras start having problems.
That looks like the turbo's finally cried enough. That white smoke is always a bad indication, dearie me. That looks like the turbo has had it for the day.
John Bauer brings in the 17 car. Well, you can't see much around the car.
There's smoke all over the place. You can barely see the guy. There's Bauer. He's got smoke in his eyes. What a tragedy for Dick Johnson.
That is not the place you park at Mount Panorama. Let me tell you, the exit to BP Cutting, he's going to try and see if he can fire it, or he's going to reverse it into that little area. Ray Lintott, Gary Rush car going through one of the Corollas, and also I think he's overshot the area there anyway. He's trying to back it, but he's going to be hard in against the wall, unless some of the marshals can assist. At least he's off the racing line there. I think this gap is down appreciably. 6 laps to go. Just waiting to time the gap as Paul Radisich goes across the line. About 13 seconds, 12 to 13 seconds.
2 seconds a lap.
Crowd absolutely berserk. Last turn, checkered flag. How does it feel? Tui's champ, Alan Grice.
The best feeling I've had since 1986, I've got to tell you.
Well done, son. You've driven superbly. The Seven Network welcomes you to Bathurst. The 29th edition of the great race. They're racing.
1991. Can the Nissans win, or how can they be beaten? Can the Sierras go the distance? Can the new Commodores stop the Nissans? These are the questions.
Jim Richards missed the kick initially, but they're all through the first turn and heading up mountain straight now for the first time. No incidents through past the sand trap. And Mark Gibbs, the young Sydney driver, driving for Bob Forbes Racing in the GIO Nissan. There he is, out in front. Jimmy Richards back in third, and it looks like a great start from Dickie Johnson or John Bauer. Look at this, as Glenn Seaton on the inside. Here he comes. Car number 30 through on the inside of Dick Johnson. He may have missed the start, as Gary pointed out. Well, straight over the top of their track cam is Jim Richards, the exit from Mazda Corner, and he now works Conrod straight. That's the gap back to second. Mark Gibbs, a little taily coming out of there. Then followed by John Bauer. Next one is Drew Price. The approach shot now to Caltex Chase, where they are absolutely flat strap. Now down on the brakes through the gears, when Percy closes up on the tail of the Pride of Queensland, but gets it sideways. And out goes Percy. Will he hit the wall? He saves it. Brakes are locked on. Percy has been able to save that, the 16 car.
But there is damage on that front right-hand guard. Look at that.
So that would put the young Victorian Glenn Seaton in the Peter Jackson Sierra up into the lead, car number 30.
Reasonably slick stop that was too for the number one Nissan, just under 30 seconds.
Yes, Seaton leads from Mark Gibbs in the GIO Nissan GTR, followed by Dick Johnson.
They've been rehearsing a lot of pit stops here at Mount Panorama during the week, the Johnson team. In he comes. Belts are already undone. Johnson out of the car, John Bauer steps straight in.
Brief holidays pit report. There's no holiday though for John Bauer. He's earning his money today.
Certainly is today. Topping it up with gas, fresh rubber, Dunlops all round for the number 17 car.
Been in the pits for 20 seconds. The arms are up. Just wait for the refueling, which is usually the slowest part of these stops. Johnson still plugging Bowen. Bowen on the ground and out in 30 seconds. A good stop from the Shell team.
Lost another one.
Now that might be the same car. You get a look at it side on. If it's 44, it's dumped another wheel. 43.
Sister car.
The team car. So there's three Sierras have lost the left front wheel. Sorry, the...
Is that the left front? That's the right front.
Right front, yeah. Sorry. And left and right-hand drive cars, very confusing.
Your so another one never will... did know what the right hand was doing.
Another one will limp down the hill.
They've already changed the pads on this car once. Now, they had them on standby if they thought they'd get any hand help out of changing them again. They've obviously decided not to. The problem's in the hydraulics. They're going to try and run with that and get by on the spongy pedal. It's still working enough. The interesting thing is, as was mentioned about the splash and dash, they've now worked out they will need one more stop at the end of this race. It will be a 10-litre stop of petrol. That's all they'll need to stick in the car. It will be a very, very quick one. So if all goes well according to this one, and it looks like doing just that, in fact, it's done very, very well indeed for this change for them. If this spongy brake pedal holds out, they will have one very, very quick pit stop left.
That pit stop, Nissan rejoined in first place, but we've got problems for the 17 car, John Bauer.
Oh dear, smoke pouring from the front left-hand wheel.
That's looking looking fairly terminal. And that's looking even worse.
Yep, the Seaton car was coughing and spluttering its way out, and it hasn't even made it out of pit lane.
Back on track with the Synovus entry, Alan Moffat, car 10. This is the car with Gianfranco Brancatelli at the wheel at the moment, the car that he's sharing with Charlie O'Brien and running in fourth place and catching the GIO Nissan at the present time. So a battle looming here for third position.
As Jimmy Richards comes down at the end of Conrod Strait.
Well, 10 years ago, 1981, Nissan began their campaign for outright honours at Mount Panorama.
Last lap board now. There's Gentler Jim. Looks for Bathurst victory. Number four. Here he comes. The very last corner of the 1991 Tooheys 1000 at Mount Panorama Bathurst. Checkered flag, Jim Richards, Nissan. That's his car. We are 10 seconds away from the start of one of the really great sporting spectacles of Australia, the Tooheys 1000.
1992 is the 30th anniversary of the great race. Brock is back with Holden. Nissan still racing. But can the Sierras stop their reign? And then there's the reintroduction of the Ford V8.
Sitting there as the rest of the field goes through the first turn and works their way now up Mountain Straight. Dick Johnson away to a brilliant start. And there's the second of the Johnson cars back in car number 18 as Johnson starts to stretch it. Mark Scaife gets up very, very smartly indeed, follows up. Mark Gibbs also away to a great start, the first of the Commodores, and Seaton now starting to pick it up. That's Thomas Mazier in the 15 car, qualified so strongly as they go over Repco Corner and head up the mountain for the first time. Fabulous sight, only Peter Brock stalling at the starting line. So a change in the lead as the Nissan GTR goes through to lead it. Johnson hangs to the outside. He's going to let Mark Scaife set the pace for a while now. The Dunlop race cam shows the gap first back to second as they work Mountain Straight.
As you've seen all week, straight line speed. There's nothing in this with these cars, and Dick's got the advantage of the tow. Pulls out of the draft, and this is just sheer horsepower. Aerodynamics working on these cars. 280 kilometres an hour as they head up Mountain Straight.
Dick's trying to blow him off before they get to the right-hander, but I don't think he'll make it there.
Scaife goes deeper under brakes. These guys will be mindful. These cars are running on full tanks of fuel, new tyres, and they've got 6.5 hours of racing to go. He's a guy who does do a lot of motorsport. Glenn Seaton having a drink on the bottle.
It's morning tea time.
Now, this guy... The
just looks so relaxed behind the wheel of a racing car. It's almost beyond belief.
He's carrying our Castrol race cam for us today in the Falcon EB, running ninth on the road at the moment. And he'll hand over to another guy who's used to the wet too, and Alan Jones. He honestly looks like about a 14 or a 15-year-old, doesn't he, Glenn?
Especially with a tube in his mouth taking liquid refreshments. Here we are, another drama.
Really is surprising. Larry was in fifth position. Or
this is the Wayne Park 35 car, the Peter Jackson Sierra.
He's given the wall a severe clout.
He was lucky to get back.
So there'll be all sorts of damage under their brake ducts. You can see the brake duct there damaged, front spoiler, all sorts of stuff.
What a pleasant afternoon hurtling around here with a turbocharged Ford Sierra and trying to keep the thing on the island.
We've got a spin, I believe, Michael.
Yep, have a look at that on replay. And that, of course,
Kevin Waldock.
Is Kevin Waldock in the playscape, but not playsafe.
He won't escape that.
Yeah, that's not bad, actually. Well, Kevin, great four-wheel drive advantages.
He's kept the boot into it.
How has he done that? He's absolutely and
well,
gone out. No.
That's a genius effort.
A wave, too.
Well, and he gives the wave.
The playscape Ampol Sierra that John Hewson is masterminding the pit stops.
Bit of off-road ability. Yeah.
There's JB.
Bow is going very, very slowly on this lap.
All that water, and now a bit of sand. It's like a day at the beach there. Apparently the sand goes harder when it gets wet, Mike, which is why people can escape it in these conditions, whereas normally they'd be there for the rest of the day.
He was very lucky. Good driving there on the part of Kevin Waldock.
John Bow staying out there.
I don't think maybe he has a lot of damage. That looks superficial, but he was giving it something underneath.
I think his only problem is trying to drive a Ford Sierra in the rain, and we'll just listen to how gingerly he applies the power in this car. Yeah.
Just listen to the wheels buzzing.
You hear the turbo come on like a bomb. Heaps of wheel spin. Not conditions suited to this high boost turbo Ford.
Thanks to Dunlop, our race cam, we can bring you the pictures out of the Dick Johnson car as JB heads up to Repco. Drivers are facing here today.
That's the
we've had a big accident, the Marathon Foods Commodore.
And the other, it's the second Caltex car.
Yeah, Caltex car 7. The pace car is onto the circuit. And that's been quite a high-speed shunt between these two cars. Caltex 7 driven by Peter Hopwood and Terry Bosanjak.
Not much of the boot left there. I hope he didn't have his golf clubs in.
Let's have a look what happens. Here is the Hopwood car coming up. It's going to pull out and has drilled the Commodore right in the rear, and you can see what has happened. He's put himself around, and there goes the Commodore. He's trying to bring it back under control. He'll hit the wall on the right. And then straight across to the left, and how on earth he has just missed being hit again. That was a very, very spectacular incident. So back we go back to racing.
The battle-scarred Peter Jackson Sierra leads them across the line for the first time as the leaders begin to pick their way through the back markers. The Winfield Nissan's tucked in there.
That was a bit of late braking there, but it looked like it was perhaps Manuel Reuter.
Sure was.
The car's still coming down. It'll only be a lap or so under the pace car, I would think. Dickie Johnson. Gee, I tell you what, he is hanging on like you couldn't believe today. It's a day for the old pros, Dick.
You never know, Mike, do you?
Do you never know? Do you reckon you could, if you could do a pit stop for a bit of a four-wheel drive adjustment, it would help?
Oh, mate, you wouldn't believe. Bowie, this is Bowie's car that he used all year.
Yeah.
And you know, he likes, you know, these little bits and pieces in the car. He's fairly fussy, you know. And he's got pipes coming. There's more donkey's things in here than I've ever seen in my whole life. They're here. And all they're doing is filling up with water and blowing water all over the inside of the windscreen. So I need a wiper on the inside as well as the outside.
Tell me, how's the car running?
It's fantastic. It really is fantastic. But as I said, what are we? Almost halfway, but gee, we've still got a long way to go.
Yes, there is a long way to go. If it goes full distance, I hope you got a good set of floodlights.
Well, I tell you what, I don't think I've got any floodlights. The lights are covered on the front, so I might have to get a couple of
one of those ones with the stick-on doobies on the side here.
Peter Jackson, Falcon V8. Did a very impressive debut here at Mount Panorama. Basically an untried car. And AJ, our former Formula One world champion, concentrating.
In 11th place.
Haven't had the opportunity with race cam before to watch Alan Jones. Been sensational, of course, in the BMWs. Just like another day at the office.
It's a different look to see them, though. You've got to put the wide-angle lens on when you're trying to get pictures of Jonesy. He can't hear me, can he, Mike?
Oh, I just hate to think that he could.
He's a violent man.
As Jimmy Richards goes through.
Dick Johnson jumping into the number 17 Shell Sierra, the new race leader. They are changing tyres. They're going to have a look at the brake pads. They're not quite sure if they're going to change it. Team manager Ross Stone, I only spoke 2 seconds ago, said they are going to have a look at them. This is their last chance. They do have the lead and they don't want to give it up. I say that as the Nissan of Jim Richards goes straight past the start-finish line. It doesn't look like they're going to change the pads from here. As just as I say that too, they do. This windscreen getting a bit of a clean. Johnson's ready to go. A face of stone. John Bauer gets out dripping wet, but a very happy man. And everything seems to be going to plan. The back wheels are fine. We're just waiting on the two front wheels as they simultaneously put the pads on now. It will only be a matter of seconds here at the Shell pit.
This stop is actually taking a lot longer, I think, than the team would wish. 40 seconds, just over 40 seconds was what the Nissan managed to do it in. He still rejoins in second position there.
Dick Johnson, relatively unscathed, arm raised. Now, I don't know whether his arm is raised in what he thinks might be victory, but the indications that we've been given is that the number one Nissan will still be declared the race winner.
There's the carnage coming out of Forest Elbow. John Brady with Ivan Stibart. Hopefully we'll clear the air.
Yes, thank you very much, Mike. Ivan, red flag, it is all over, Red Rover?
All over, yes, unfortunately. But as you can see now, the weather's clearing up, but it's too late, it's all over. So we've declared it, and the timekeepers are now working out the final result.
Not afraid that you may have jumped a little early?
No, not if you saw what was happening there with some of those cars. It was a bit dangerous, and unfortunately, some of them don't heed the caution flags, and you only need one or two to do that, and that's what caused that problem.
Okay, the $64 question, who is the winner?
I would say car one. The race has got to be declared at the last full lap before the red flag went out, and he was still leading at that stage.
How close was he to the next full lap at the time?
Not sure until we get to the timekeepers on that, but he had a full lap up on him on the other cars, so that should be okay.
The demon from Daisy Hill is ready to run. So the field almost set now. 10 seconds away from the start.
1993, it's heart-stopping action. The return of the big Aussie V8s.
Who will it be into the first turn?
It's Ford versus Holden.
Off, racing, Perkins by the country mile. Wins the start, Scape is nobbled by about three on the inside as they come roaring up to the first turn. Scape goes back a couple. Johnson was up on the inside of Scape to keep the pressure on him as they round that turn. We're off to a fine start. One of the PJ cars back in the field, perhaps that could be Brabham, Jeff Brabham.
Yeah.
But they make their way up the hill over the crest beneath the MasterCard bridge, and they're on their way to the first right-hander. Look at Perkins opening it up, and the two Telecom Mobile Net Commodores off to a brilliant start.
Glenn Seaton trying to push through on the inside there. Thankfully, a nice clean start to the 1993 Tuohy's 1000. But look at Perkins. He said he wanted to break this field apart. He wants to set the pace and demolish the opposition. He's doing it the right way in this opening lap as the HRT cars following through. First of the Winfield cars and Glenn Seaton in fifth.
Crompton made a move up on the outside of one of the Shell cars but had to tuck in. Brock is behind him. And then, of course, we have the second of the Winfield cars.
It is spoiler and tyre damage. That's going to be a very expensive mistake. As David Parsons brings the car into pit lane.
Let's go down to Eddie Raymond.
Yes, you're exactly right, Mark Osler. A front spoiler. David was hit apparently from behind hell corner on the first lap. They're going to have a look at tyres. They're going to have a look at the front axle. There's a little concern, as you can see on the screen now, that Bridgestone front spoiler is going on. A very costly error for Team Peter Jackson.
And Johnson closer this time to the tail of Seaton's car. The rest of them are not too far behind. There's Neil Crompton, the GIO Australia, Bob Forbes Commodore, sitting in behind Johnson.
They work the front straight one more time as we take Dunlop race cam riding with Dick. Shows the crowd off to the right. Johnson position six on the right.
Sedan locks it up right in front of him.
Oh dear, oh dear. That was a very...
Keep it out of the sand.
He'll stay out of the sand, but he's got a lot of cars now to try and pass him, and that was probably something that Glenn Seaton didn't need, and you saw it on race cam. Seaton gets it back under control again. Watch what? This from another angle, Seaton.
What on earth happened there?
But he catches it, and he's already looking to see where Dick is, lets it float, and tries to stop it as quickly as he can to let the cars up the inside of him.
He's a lucky boy. Now, there's one of the two-litre cars already out of the race, sitting against the earth bank on the approach to BP Cutting.
Greg Easton and Kurt Kratzman, I think car 66, yes it was.
Not a good place to park for the remainder of the day. So we go back aboard Dick Johnson's Shell Falcon. Just give you an insight into the engine telemetry that these top touring car teams have access to. If you look on the left, you've got revolutions per minute. You can see Dick's hovering around 6,500 as they head across the top of the mountain. Beside that is road speed in kilometres per hour. Look at the speed, 180 kilometres an hour through this narrow part of the track. Death-defying stuff. Beside that is the gear change points. You can see Dick's almost flat in fourth gear. Nev Gardner in front of him. And below that, a brake indicator. And you can see, as he's on and off the middle pedal, the light comes on and off. So you've got a good insight into just how hard the Shell Falcon's working. And boy, isn't he working Gardner hard?
Sure is. And you just keep your eye on that speed readout as they head down Conrod towards Caltex Chase, because it'll top out somewhere about 280.
Look at this. Johnson has more looked in the inside. Oh! He's collided. There's been a collision. Hey, Johnson and Gardner have both spun. Car 18 picks its way through. Gardner survives, but Dick...
It's the oncoming traffic that's the worry here. Dear, he's right in the racing line. Look, John Bauer.
Looking on from the pits, and he's trying to get a gear. He's slipping further and further back. You can see the smoke belching from the exhaust as he tries to get the thing going. The engine's actually running, so he's rolling back to see if he can spin it around and get it pointing in the right direction. Dear, dear. That was a costly mistake. Seaton, meanwhile, moves up to 10th position after that earlier spin. What a shame for Dick Johnson. Let's look at that again on our action replay. He's been giving Gardner hell for these three or four laps preceding. He has a look down the inside. And he gets the back away. And just as he's sliding, he gives Gardner a little tap into the bargain.
Great effort to keep it off the wall.
Yeah, he kept it off the wall. Gardner managed to recover too.
Not a bad effort by Radisich to get round him.
Fortunately, 18 was able to thread the needle. So Dick's back in the race. What a shame.
They're up to 15th. They are also just taking it very, very easy today. They plan to be around at 4.15 in the top 10. Beautifully turned out car. First race start for Alan Moffat's new Butte Falcon EV.
I'll tell you who else is in the top 10, Mike. Unheralded, too, coming off 12th position on the grid. Dunstan and Harrington in the 55 car. They're operating out of the Mobil 1 camp, but in a different livery under the Pepsi banner, and they're doing a damn good job. They're up to 8th position.
Yes, they've done a fine job. I noticed just a second ago the PJ team was standing back for Glenn Seaton to come in. Seaton in car number 30, this Ford pit report. Checking out, they're quite happy with their brakes by the look of it.
It's very interesting as well. Both Brock and the Seaton car here have come in at 33 laps, which puts them on schedule to do the race in just the four stops. That extra stop will make a difference come the end of the race, providing they don't strike any other problems.
It's a problem here. It's the Seaton giving Glenn giving Alan a hand there with the belts.
This is a less than flash stop. They can't afford to lose this amount of time in the pits. Still up on the air, Jax.
Going to be interesting to see how Alan Jones copes with the stint behind the wheel too, because he has been ill and quite weak.
Dear, oh dear, that was almost a minute, that stop. The Kevin Waldock Komatsu Falcon sits off to the side of the entry to Griffin's Bend. That's the end of Mountain Straight.
That is indeed a pity for Kevin Waldock.
Got another one in trouble, the Alan Moffat Falcon. There's no one sitting in that car, and that, I think, it will remain for the end of the day.
So that's the Andrew Medici Charlie O'Brien Synovus Falcon.
But this is the drama of the race.
He's got to get to the pits too, because he's got a tyre rubbing up there.
What a shame. It was in position three.
And this is where a bit of experience comes into. He's better off cooling this now and taking it very slowly. He doesn't need to pop that tyre.
It's going to disintegrate before he gets there.
Tell you what, you want to open those windows too. The inside of the car is just chock-a-block full of smoke. He's opened the window there and he's slowing down. I wonder if he can get it back to the pits. That tyre will be in shreds in very short order.
The modified Shell Racing, number 18. Let's take a look at what actually happened. We looked at the top of screen, and here he comes. He's got over the curb.
Yeah, unbalanced it.
He's going to kiss the wall here.
Look out.
That is not the best putt. See how much pressure on the side of the car. I'm glad he hit on the tail section and hit the door.
Oh.
How close was that for the Thomas Mazzera going through? You got a lively pit stop coming up, Rich.
I sure have, Mike, and I'll tell you, there's some very disappointed faces down here and an awful lot of damage to this car. It hit the wall very hard indeed. Paul Radisich has just put his helmet on, I think, to get into the car, but I think it'll be a while before it's going anywhere, looking at this sort of damage. The whole of the rear end has taken a huge whack against the wall. Apart from the damage that you can see to the wing, there's no telling what's happened underneath of there.
Yeah.
And, of course, driving it all the way back down the mountain and down Conrod without a rear tyre on it won't have done it any good either.
Yeah, it could have done anything. I mean, it could have moved the rear suspension across the car. The car might be driving in a crab-like manner.
Real drama, the 17 car of Dick Johnson. The way down from the top of the mountain has clouted the wall. Was running sixth.
Goodness me.
Pace car is on the track. This is a big one.
Slower car got out of control, and T-Bone Johnson, he was the innocent victim in that. He was trying to get past, and the Everlast Commodore got sideways on the ripple strips and just leapt straight across the track, pushing Johnson right into the fence. Well, it had to happen. They've been complaining about the slow cars all week. Dick's got a bit of a limp there. He's probably damaged his ankle when he hit the concrete wall. John Bow looking absolutely disgusted. He would have seen the replay there.
Peter Jackson, Nissan, Glenn Seaton, car 30. Hasn't had any
Peter Jackson Falcon.
Other than mechanical, I think.
Gee, that's not a place to stand, Glenn. Coming hammering across the top of Skyline there. Now, is this going to call out a pace car?
Officials suggesting that he hop over the fence.
Oh, dear. 10 laps to go. Disappointed Peter Jackson crew watching the monitor in the garage. Glenn switches the lights off. This is interesting. Now they're going to call out a pace car to get this thing off the track.
Now through the gears, a couple of cars to deal with before the checkered flag comes out.
Good on you, sir.
Yes, he's done very well. He coasts out of here. Bridgestone Bridge is the next landmark as he hauls it down here, and the throats of all the fans are starting. Perkins, Perkins, Perkins. And why not? One of the best victories. He's done it in the new V8 Formula. Larry Perkins wins the Tui's 1000. And this man going after number 10. They call him the King of the Mountain, Peter Brock. And we're set to go. Seaton, the start here will be critical. 5 seconds away from it, the Peter Jackson Falcon on pole. Scape's ready to go.
The 1994 race will rate as the most competitive touring car race ever held at Mount Panorama. Watch rookie Craig Lowndes. But the Fords are back in the race.
He goes in wide, but he won't be able to turn it out of there. And it'll be Seaton up the inside. Heading up the Holden Hill. Here comes Scafe. He wants to lead this. Up on the inside. Seaton has allowed him to get up on the inside. And he was 2 seconds quicker this morning. Scafe running on the Yokohamas. And there he goes through Repco now. The exit. Seaton now drops back into second. Third, as you can see, is Peter Perfect. And Larrick and Larry Perkins coming up the outside.
Wild stuff as this field thunders through the spray on the first lap. You can see Larry pushing his way up through the field there. Great start for Mark Scafe. He wants to get out of this spray and he's going to lead him across the top for the first time. There's Seaton in second position. Brock slips back to third after that big understeer in the first corner. Perkins comes through. The first of the shell cars, then Alan Jones and the Peter Jackson Ford. Well, Larry Perkins as we go with Castrol race cam aboard the Castrol Commodore. And Alan Jones, isn't he on a charge?
So the Fords are starting to make their mark here as they head down to the right-hand kink here at the chase. Alan Jones has been sitting off the leaders. Look at this. Here's Peter Brock. And the man coming after him is Alan Jones. And he tries to thread the needle as they go past a lap car. Brock has the light of the next turn. It's the right-hander at Repco. Jones has the headlights ablaze. The Ford's running strongly. And he wants to lead it as he comes up the inside. Brock skates wide. Jones comes up. The two cars almost touch that time. Brock has the line to the next turn on the inside. But Jones stays wide. Watch this as they come on opposite lock out of here, and it's Brock with Jones side by side again.
Ford versus Holden. Alan Jones is more than into the quarter panel of Brock's car there. Brock's got the left-hand indicator on as Alan Jones tucks right under the wing of 05 as they come across the mountain for this scintillating run through these conditions. This is really...
And all those experts have told us that these were dinosaurs from the past. Go eat your words, boys. These guys are putting on a fabulous show as Jones goes to the inside but can't make it.
You can't believe this. This is the battle for the lead of the 1994 Tooheys 1000. It's not a sprint race. Well, it is effectively 161 laps. We can expect this sort of action
Here's
for
Neil
six Chambry. And a half hours.
Good driving from Neil Chambry.
Rookie gets out of the way. Nice driving by him as he lets this great battle continue. Alan Jones in the Ford, Peter Brock in the Holden. Holden versus Ford, and they're right on it as they come down toward Forest Elbow once again. All this aggression we've seen in Jones over the years coming out here, and he's picked the right day of the year to do it.
Now they'll have a chance here to gauge the relative speed difference of these two cars as they hit Conrod Straight. Brocky, some lap cars, moves to the outside, going to get them before the chase. Jones follows, sitting in the draft. About 285 clicks at the moment over the top beneath the Tooheys Bridge. Here they come down the hill. Jones sweeps to the inside but can't do it. They lose the BMW. And they're down at a Caltex chase again, and here comes Jones under Brock and gets him as well. So we now have a new race leader. It's Alan Jones in car number 30.
You can see Jones is wearing the battle scars from that first or second lap altercation. He's really been in the wars.
Occupational hazard, son.
So interesting thing too here, maybe a coincidence, but the leading three cars now are on Bridgestone tyres. So as the track conditions are changing, you can see you've got to be on the right tyre at the right time. Jones gets sideways up on the ripple strips. Brock takes advantage with a faster run out of the corner. They're side by side as they come across the start-finish line once again.
Jones. I can't remember one like this, Gary.
I have never seen a battle like this before.
Yeah. Great view, Andrew Medecki in the Synovus Vitamins car, carrying our Dunlop race cam. Great view from the floor shows you how busy the driver is actually in the car and how many gear changes.
Still doing 2 minutes 26, is still at least 10 seconds off the fast guys at the moment and probably dropping back at that rate.
Back to the pits, Alan Jones, car 30, second of the Peter Jackson entries, and also with a problem there.
Well, he saw that smoke before when he was going up the mountain. Clearly a problem, a mechanical problem.
Let's go down to Andy.
An oil leak of some type, Alan.
Yeah, Andy, we don't know what it is. It might be a union or something, and it's leaking from underneath. So hopefully if we can tighten it up, he'll get on his way. And the other good thing is I had a misfire in Top Gear all my session, and I just said to Skippy, then have you still got the misfire? He said, no, it's going like an arrow. So we've fixed the misfire, and now we've got an oil leak.
The race leader in the Shell FAI Falcon. Second is Colin Bond. Third is Tony Longhurst. Fourth is Greg Hansford in the Castrol Commodore. And fifth is Peter Brock in the Telecom Mobile Net Commodore. So Dickie Boy leads the field, hauled in Colin Bond, who had a quite good lead and has been able to run away from Colin at this stage as he heads along pit straight. And for the first time today, the entire pit straight is just about dry.
Mike just said you're an old fella, but you're doing a pretty good job for an old fella, Dick.
Oh, I don't know about that, mate. If the weather stays like this, I'll be really, really happy old fella, I can tell you.
That car obviously working very well. The chassis looks great, plenty of power. It's really working well around Mount Panorama today.
Yeah, it is working very well, and that's basically what we're here for, is to get a car with a good setup, and we've struck on the deal here, and I think if the weather hangs out for us, everything goes right, well, we're looking good.
Here they come on the inside to take over second spot. So Paul Radisich of New Zealand, for our Kiwi viewers today through TV2 in New Zealand, hope you're enjoying the great race coverage. And Paul Radisich now takes the number one PJ Falcon up into second spot.
Paul Radisich comes firing into pit lane. Now Glenn Seaton swapping drink bottles with Paul at the moment. Looks like Paul's going to do a double stint. Yeah, he plugs in a new bottle. So Radisich really on fire. Now what are they doing? They are doing a front pad change. They've got the spreaders in there, new pads going in, old ones out. Very busy pit activity down the Peter Jackson stop, and it's looking pretty slick. They're changing pads on all four wheels, so brake pad wear and consumption going up as the track continues to dry. It's a hot pace here. Radisich calling to Glenn, they're comparing notes, making sure everything's okay. But gee, this car's sounding sweet.
Johnson said, well, the race is on, fellas, catch me if you can. So Johnson gets into the bottom corner. There's Andrew Medecki, Jeff Allen, Tony Longhurst made the break. Thomas Mazzera wasn't as quick to pick it up. But as they head up into Ford Care Turn, Johnson is away smartly. And there is Brad Jones in 015 giving chase. Longhurst runs third in the pack. Further back to Mazzera, Larry Perkins is one spot back behind him.
So every split second will count here. Here they come. Brad Jones in, and Dick, they stop at exactly the same time almost.
Let's go to Andy.
Thanks, Mark. As you can see, John Bow getting in the two times Dick Johnson has won the event. He's never actually received the checkered flag himself, and they're hoping that'll be the case today if all goes to plan. They've left it with 33 laps to go. Richard May mentioned that's optimum timing earlier. Johnson is out.
The first guy out was Brad Jones,
and down there with the action was Richard Hay.
The crowd just gave a big cheer, and this is what they gave the cheer for. Just coming through Hell Corner, John Bow ducked under Craig Lowndes. So he goes off in charge of the leaders. Longhurst rejoins in fifth position after that stop.
Actually, it was a bit of a moment of truth for Craig Lowndes, because Bow left it right until the end of pit straight and dived underneath him, and it was make your own arrangement.
Well, Johnny Bow, as he's proven over the years driving for the Shell team, a very, very difficult guy to pass. He'll make that Falcon 20 feet wide if he has to.
I tell you what, in this situation, I think I'd much prefer to be in the 015 car than the 17 car. I think it's much easier to chase than to lead in these circumstances.
And look at him tucking right under the wing of car 17. You couldn't get much closer than that.
7.83.
Oh, he's got it!
He's put one on him up the hill. I didn't think it was possible.
Holden Racing team, plenty of cheers and clapping the hands. This kid is dynamite. How many times, I don't think a rookie's ever turned up at Bathurst, apart from a few of the international drivers who have come in and done this well. Phenomenal effort from Craig. They said the transition from a little Formula 4 to a V8 was too much. Well, he's proven them wrong.
Look at this.
Down across the mountain under the Firestone Dipper.
Can't get any closer than this. It's astounding. Lowndes was apparently 0.7 seconds quicker on that previous lap, but he's making it up and losing it, as the JB does as well. So
you probably won't see this as they go down the straight, but I'm told the crowd is actually so excited they're doing a giant Mexican wave the whole length of Conrod Straight as Lowndes and Bow come through.
I've never seen a battle for the lead at Bathurst in my life like this. This is incredible. Bow closes under brakes.
Oh, now his trouble is some traffic. Let's see if this has any impact.
No, John. He'll sit in there, but he's going to make life. There's a lot at stake here. There's $100,000 to win this race. Lowndes comes down under brakes. JB, same time.
Oh, no! He couldn't have looked.
He didn't look, but that's racing.
Now, John will have got a faster run out of that corner. Yep. He may try and capitalise here. He's probably got a few more revs on board. He comes up the inside, side by side under brakes, and JB will sneak through. They both lock the inside left tyre.
He was unsettled by that back marker. That's very unfortunate.
So, Brad, watching his teammate, every move, every gear change, every brake application, fingers, toes, everything crossed. And wouldn't it be the same feeling in the Shell team at the moment?
It's Johnny Bow with the seven race camp turning circles beside him.
There's another one of those pictures speaks 1,000 words, Dick Johnson.
Somebody sent...
Sideways drift there onto the main straight again for John Bow. Corrects it quickly, though, and doesn't lose any ground. Craig Lowndes. There's that camera going round and round and round and round alongside Johnny Bow, but he wouldn't even know it was there. Last lap board is about to go out for John Bow. One to go, Johnny.
Last lap board hanging in the air. 6.2 kilometres to go for John Bow as he tails off the final lap of the 1994 Tuohy's 1000. What a race it's been.
Well, the good Lord willing and the creeks don't rise. John Bow is on his way to the first Ford Falcon victory since 1981, I think.
And let's see if we can join John Bow aboard the 17 Shell FAI Falcon. John Bow, how does it feel?
Oh, mate, what a race. What a race.
You've got it parceled up now, son.
I think it's taken 10 years off my life. I've just got to say, though, that this car is just the best car that's ever been built in touring car racing. And the Dunlop tyres were just fantastic, and it's just, I mean, it's overwhelming.
All that is true, but Dick and yourself have done a mighty job. The checkered flag is out for you.
Is the moment. Savour it, John.
John Bow wins the 1994 Tuohy's 1000. Dick Johnson is absolutely jubilant, as you'd expect. Craig Lowndes and Brad Jones, a great job in 015 to finish second, holding up the Holden flag.
Are you ready? The winners of the great race, Dick Johnson and John Bow.
magnificent day here at Mount Panorama at Bathurst as we await the start. A great crane camera shot at the start line. A lot of pressure on young Craig Lowndes. He'll have heaps of it on. He'll probably run and try and run like a scalded cat this morning. But he'll have a couple of old hands to keep him in check. They're off. They're racing.
1995. It's a great day. Set up for a fast start for the Battle of the V8s.
They've swamped the pole sitter. They make it to the corner. Wayne Gardner and the Coke machine's in there. Jimmy Richards in second spot as they take the exit out of the turn and work their way up the mountain. And Glenn Seaton, very smartly into stride, heads up the mountain to the top of the hill.
As you were talking, Alan, John Bowe got very wide on the corner exit there, put the wheel up on the ripple strip, got a slow corner exit speed, and of course Alan Jones was able to capitalise, sneaks through. So John Bowe getting a little bit out of shape. I hope that's not tyres sending a warning sign at this early stage of the race. 15 laps in.
And we ride again with Glenn Seaton having a little...
Got him.
Oh, he's driven by him. He's driven by him. That wasn't...
Very tidy move at all.
John's in trouble. He's got the wobbles up. Glenn just drove right by him.
Gee, he lost
John's a got
lot
a problem
of speed.
Here.
He lost a lot of speed coming through Repco there. Got way offline.
I think I fear for a rear tire with that amount of wobble that we would detect in with the onboard camera.
Well, look how much time Bowe now has lost to Seaton after he got past. He's just rocketed away. Apparently the fuel light is on in the Shell 17 Ford, so they're stretching it to every last drop they can get out of it.
Well, that would normally tell him that he's got two laps, although you can't be certain how big their catch tank is for the fuel system. But once the warning's light on, he's not going to be out there for another half hour.
Big hole that Gardner's punching in the air for him. 280 clicks, gets right up behind, going to take advantage.
That's tough going too. He's earning his keep today, but wow, there you go.
Well, Neil Crompton.
Neil saw that coming and said, fine, you can take it, Dick.
Well, at the moment, we see you running in second spot behind Mark Scaife and Neil Crompton back behind you. Car feel good?
The car feels okay. It's just because of the temperature of the day, the old tyres get a bit squishy. But we'll just have to battle on and just hope we can keep up the pace because those guys up there are the ones we want to nail.
Well, you're not going to let a Yokohama get between you and a chequered flag, are you, Dick?
You've got to be joking. You know, I stick with Dunlop.
Enough for the free plugs. Back to you later. Thanks, mate.
All right.
Well, given that it doesn't rain here today and all the forecasts are presumably more confident of it, I don't really believe it will. Without another pace car, you can estimate the time of the race finish around about 4.13 to 4.15. It comes from Alan Horsley, who's our race statistician. He's pretty good here at Mount Panorama for the Mazda team. Let me tell you, they've won the 12-hour for 4 years in a row. Look at this. The exit to the chase. Bowie gets away, though, heading down. He's got Wayne Park just in front of him. He's got a dive down the inside here under brakes, is he? And Glenn's there.
Yeah, it's cost him time. It was just unfortunate. The Castro car was just there when John needed the room to flow through the corner. He'll take him now, but it got Glenn that spot he wanted. He can now chase him up mountain straight.
Yes, he'll be riding the slipstream, won't he?
He will. He's there now. He's got either one. Take your choice, Glenn.
I'd go with the yellow one.
I think so.
They head up straight again. I think it is Wayne Park. Seaton tries to get an advantage and jump out down the inside, and Bowers into a bit of defensive stuff as well. Seaton moved to the inside. Across went John.
He's just trying to get a better line there, Mike. He knows that John can go defensively, but it will be ultimately slower. And Glenn's still trying to muscle up here on him. Camera deflection there. Looked like he was a little closer than he really was, but he is very close at the moment.
This has been a fabulous race.
It's hard to do as well.
He's got him sideways!
No, I don't believe he touched him.
No,
I don't believe he did touch him.
Wasn't much in it.
He hit him, but I think John lost it. I don't believe Glenn touched him.
Well, they've gone through. I don't know what damage it's done to the... to the Glenn Seaton car, but they have had a touch. Whoop, and he's got coolant coming out of the car.
Yep.
Johnson just can't believe it.
He's devastated, but I honestly don't believe Glenn touched him.
Well, poor old Dick Johnson was watching there in the monitor down in his pit, and you saw the look of absolute mortification, disgust on his face.
Let's go down to Richard. Richie?
Well, thanks, Mike. An awful lot of damage by the looks of things to the front of the car. The spoiler coming off, there's another spoiler here. The team were expecting
A car in for a pit stop, but I suspect that that was the 18 car, not the 17 car at that point. Now, they're also taking this opportunity to do brake pads, so perhaps there won't be that much time loss, but there's also liquid coming from the front of the car. They've shut the engine down now. And this is going to be a bit longer than just a new spoiler and changing the brake pads and the tyres. A look underneath the bonnet and there's an awful lot of water coming out the front of this car at the moment.
Yes, yeah. Engine coolant. You can see it there running away.
It got the radiator and the green dye coolant preservative.
Glenn, that was an anxious moment or so.
Yeah, it was, Mike.
Would you like to tell us exactly what happened from your perspective?
Well, from where I was, I went to go up the inside of John and he's just moved right over on me. So really, if you have a look at it, it's right off race line. He is. Cuts across the front of me and but I come right up the throttle, brake, to try and stop avoiding him, but it was too far up the side of him.
Yeah, well, they just spoke to Bauer, who believes it's your fault, not his.
Ah, well, that's pretty normal for John.
Okay, mate, thanks for that.
Thank you.
Nick Johnson rejoins the race, car number 17, but some info here on Russell Ingall and Larry Perkins. You'll recall after they had their problem this morning, they came out of the racetrack and they were 29th. And they were 2 minutes and 10 seconds behind the pack. Now they're in sixth spot, 1 minute 29 behind the leaders and gaining. I mean, that is just the outstanding performance so far. The exit now to Forest Elbow to work Conrod Strait. And a problem here for Glenn Seaton. He's come out of the corner and the engine is off song in the number 30 Peter Jackson Falcon. And just look how quickly Larry Perkins is gaining. What wretched luck here for Seaton. He's had this one absolutely locked up and Perkins is all over him. Into Caltech's chase, it's only a matter of time as Seaton steers out of the turn. Perkins works to the outside. There's nothing Seaton can do about it. Holden fans have gone absolutely berserk at the bottom end of the racetrack. And here is Larry Perkins on the outside going through to take the lead.
Look at Beau.
Beau is Barry absolutely Seaton. Shattered.
Glenn's father, winner here in 1965. Glenn, a shake of the head as he backs the car off the circuit. Barry Seaton in tears there. The great dream has evaporated in the space of a few seconds. Glenn Seaton in the car. We're just trying to establish that he can hear us. Glenn.
Commiserations, mate.
Yeah, Alan. Pretty disappointing.
You just can't believe it. But people around the world have said valve springs are the toughest item in any engine. You don't have to feel badly about it, mate. It is the toughest thing to win this race.
Yeah, no
commiserations
wrong.
To your dad. I know how hard you've worked.
Yeah, we've gone so close today. Just can't believe it. Like,
when did you have the first indication, Glenn? Something was wrong. Just bang, just like that, wasn't it?
Well, it was about five laps ago it started to come in, and I just thought it was going to be okay, but...
got worse.
That's life.
Glenn, that's life. There is a Tuohy's 1000 waiting for you, I guarantee. You just got to keep hanging in there.
It must be...
This is just heartbreaking, I tell you.
Absolutely, because you've got a team of guys there that have really slaved for 12 months to try and achieve this.
Absolutely, and like to come this close, it's just words can't explain it. Really can't.
Well, mate, you don't lose a race like this.
We'll let you go. Thanks, Glenn.
Thank you.
Larry Perkins and Russell Ingall, the great race winners, the Tuohy's 1000 for 1995. Well, that is just a phenomenal effort. Flag is about to drop. Track is wet. Rain has stopped. Well, it's still sprinkling. They're away! And off the line, Lowndes got the better start.
1996, it's a wet track. And how can they stop Lowndes? Can the four drivers out-muscle the Holdens? Or is the race going to be decided by the pit crews?
There's a bit of a bunch-up for 5th, 6th, 7th positions, but at the head of the field, the leaders have gone through okay. Sonova's Falcon going through all right. In the chase, cars slipping and sliding just a little, as you'd expect. A lot of water on the road.
Not actually raining, Gary, as you mentioned, but still wipers on to keep that mist and windscreen free.
Any further back than second or third, and you can't see too much.
Oh, no, it's the Mitre 10 Falcon. Mark Larkham and
There is a hoodoo on this team. There's got to be.
I cannot believe this. They qualified 11th. It was the strongest showing they've had all year. He's crunched it big time into the concrete wall on Conrod Straight.
Well, as long as he's okay, the medal can always be replaced. That's cheap.
Back at the front. And here comes Alan Jones, the 1980 World F1 champ. And boy, isn't he pumped up at Bathurst in 96. Look at him applying the thumb screws to Craig Lowndes. He's going deep under brakes. He's going to try and get him at Shell Helix corner. Alan Jones does it and takes the lead of the AMP Bathurst 1000.
A superb move.
The safety car is going to come out, we understand. So it hasn't as yet. So we're still under full race conditions at the present time. There's the car. That's it, Repco Bend and Brad Jones. Is
your... Oh, that's Alan Jones.
Alan Jones, the car's on fire, stopped in the middle of the circuit.
Goodness me, Alan Jones, well, the race leader.
That one is going to be in bad shape.
Now, they're
going
to have to get a hell of a lot more extinguishers down there to get that one
under
control.
Fellow isn't going around the other side, and I don't blame him. He doesn't want to get onto the track.
Especially the smoking.
The extinguisher is not doing the job. That is going to really get moving. If he doesn't get around behind the tire, now he's just...
No,
he's not going to do it.
He's going to get out of there.
He better walk away from it.
Yeah.
That's going to be a dangerous situation shortly.
Of Conrod Straight. I don't know what's happened, but the car is ablaze. 301, the pack leader, Falcon.
No, I think that's on the approach to the cutting, actually, Gary.
On the way up to the cutting, sorry.
Under bonnet heat, Gary, is so immense in these cars.
You can see from the commentary box, we can see the plume of smoke coming up through the trees. There's the pack leader team. Ross Stone absolutely shattered.
Look at the fire.
That is getting hold of that car big time. That is going to be a burnout very, very quickly.
I think the Marshall could be a little braver. The car will never blow up with the fuel cell safe and secure in the back. They need to address it.
Well,
looks like they've got it out.
There's no flame there. But
the heat under the bonnet on these cars is immense.
Alan Grice absolutely shattered. You saw the look on Ross Stone's face. Leading the race, 25 laps. And look how it's ended up for Pack Leader Racing. Unbelievable.
That is actually the second car that Alan Jones has been driving and has caught fire. There's one at Lakeside a couple of years ago, Glenn Seaton.
I was just thinking of that before at Lakeside. One of the Peter Jackson Falcons Jones was driving in a touring car around. That one burst into flames. Jones got out of that in a hurry, but this is a very different situation. Let's have a look at this on replay. Jones just slowing as he came up the shelf.
Bit of an electrical problem, I would say, obviously, has caused the car to come to a halt, and I don't know what has actually caused the ignition.
When he's tried to restart it, you saw the puff come out of the exhaust pipe and that lit up. He may have had a fuel pump failure or some fuel line failure, and when he's tried to restart it, it's caught fire with the fumes that must have been in the car.
Stated the right word, Alan.
I'm beside myself.
Well, you're beside me at the moment. Alan, unbelievable. This race meant so much to you in 1996 with the prospect of chasing sponsorship for next year.
Yeah, sure, but it means a great deal to everybody. I mean, there's not a single person out there now that wouldn't want to win it.
Let's take this pit stop with Andy Raymond.
Thanks, Gary. And just as John Bow pulled up, Greg Murphy in the number one HRT car went straight past. This perhaps the most crucial stop of the period for the Shell FAI team. Everything rather routine. 120 litres, four tyres, a clean of the windshield, a change of driver, and they are just about ready to go. We've been going 22, 23 seconds, and Johnson is off a good stop.
Still a good stop.
Stephen Ellery coming in, so Tony Longhurst about to get back into the 25 Castrol Falcon. Andy Raymond again.
That has been an extraordinary drive from young Stephen Ellery. If the Longhurst-Ellery combination wins Bathurst, Stephen Ellery will be the youngest driver. Again, it's a regulation pit stop, rather quick, and there's it's fantastic teamwork here between Stephen Ellery and Tony Longhurst. They really do not only just jump in and jump out of the car, they help themselves get off and going, and that is lightning, just under 22 seconds.
Johnson, race cam shows as he tries to sneak up the inside. Mark Scaife. Scaife currently running seventh.
Don't think it's the time of the day to take Dick Johnson on just quietly.
And Johnson is, of course, a lap up at this stage. So he's trying to pick his way through the traffic as he unfolds these final few laps.
Quick look in his rearview mirror there just to see whether Scaife was going to try it again.
There's the race cam view. Oh, there goes Seaton. A little bit of rivalry. No chance of winning the race, but starting to mix it up behind our second place man. The gap, meanwhile, 9.42 seconds between Lowndes and Johnson that time around. Lowndes still digging deep, but not quite as deep at 2.14.9. Johnson slipped back to a 2.16.7 that time around.
The crowd cheering him on, 46,000 fans. He gives a wave and he points it up toward the checkered flag, and Craig Lowndes wins the 1996 AMP Bathurst 1000. And surprise, surprise, the crew are ecstatic.
The engines roar, they're ready to go. A great race for 97.
1997. The Ford Mondeo takes on the 2 litres at the Mountain, with two cars entered by privateer Peter Hills. It's not all smooth sailing.
Starting the climb up Mount Panorama, up Mountain Straight. Everybody's getting round the first corner. Well, that's good. And they stream up towards Repco Bend, the first right-hander, and then into the BP cutting. And Jason Plato passes Paul Morris to take the lead in the Renault Laguna. Behind him in the Peugeot 406, it's double world champion Paul Radisich. Morris retakes the lead. It's terrific stuff on the first of 161 laps, and coming up in the background, you can see Peter Brock is in fourth position in the red and white of Vauxhall Vectra.
We are in the pits.
It's covered, instantly knows where it's not going. Car 88, Pavicevic and Hills in the pits. It's been there from the outset, did not get off the start line.
This is what happens when you have pit stops with a lot of people running around the car, and the fellow that should have been in charge didn't double-check the bonnet pins, and that would have given them a real fright. It's nothing worse, probably could have even cracked the windscreen. This is the kiss of death for any mechanic.
Is this 88 or 89?
We can't quite see the number, but if it was the 89 car.
Well, I can tell you, thanks to my diligent research, I can tell you from the yellow mirrors that it is car 89.
Oh, that's Jenny Thompson.
Yes, which is Jenny Thompson's car. Great pity, because she's clearly out of the race.
Now, let's have a look at this incident on replay here. As Jenny Thompson had left the pits after a quick pit stop. Keep your eye on the right of screen. She emerges from the pit lane here. She wasn't going at tremendous speed, which was fortunate for her. Now, there it goes. Look at that. It was just not clipped down at all. Imagine if by some means it had stayed down, Alan, until she'd achieved some speed. That would have been horrendous.
At that pace, it would have smashed the windscreen for her, but it still gave him a hell of a fright. It's happened to us all, and the reason I'm so chirpy about it, I've had it myself, and it's not fun. It's expensive, it's embarrassing, and they're going to have a lot of time to get that car back to
the... And look, there is Ulbruhl in the Audi. He was in fourth position. He's not going to finish there.
Shredded.
Because Rydell in the last stages is going to go up into fifth position. What an incredible finish as Ulbruhl limps home. Here is Craig Baird going into the last corner at Mount Panorama to win an historic and quite incredible Bathurst 1000 from his teammate David Brabham and Jeff Brabham.
It's not the best of days for privateer Peter Hills. BMW wins, but Ford will be back, and the Ford tradition will continue. Go!
Don't you mess with Mr. In Between.